Hey y'all, hey. Hey everybody. Almost bust my own eardrums, y'all. How are y'all today? Oh my goodness, y'all. Y'all have no idea what I just went through to get to y'all on time, to have the music start on time, child. Listen, talk about rushing. All right, that's what you get for trying to have love in the afternoon, child. Then you got to jump in the shower real quick because you're supposed to be live in 5 minutes. Lord have mercy. I really had like 10 minutes. Hold on. Listen, y'all show some love to my moderators, okay? Eva Lynn, Love Jones, I see you are a family, and Bikini Body Challenge. They work hard to keep us safe while we're sipping in the Speakeasy, okay? So listen now. I do believe. Wait 1 second, something is happening here. Let me see. What's going on? All right, so me and Mother are here, as well as Bikini Body Child. But let me go through my whole little spiel, right? I hope y'all wiped your feet. That's the equivalent of smashing that like button, subscribing to my channel if you haven't, and smashing that notification bell and selecting all, leaving a comment and sharing my channel on your social media. All right. Y'all do that for me, please. And also, please make sure you follow me on Instagram and Twitter. Okay? Please and thank you. All right. So, let me see who's here. Y'all saw all of the links that I dropped. There you go. Look at this thing. Just jot anywhere you push it. StreamYard is trash. Somebody call them up and tell them I said so. Please and thank you, because they're not paying any attention to my message. Hey, Mother. Welcome, Love Muffin. Thank you for being here, darling. I love and appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Bikini Body. That's my little sneaking laughing. She laughed, child. Real sneaky, like a little kid that know they just did something bad. Can I get a paper towel, please? She'll snipe the shit out of you and then give a little sneaky laugh. Okay. Thank you, darling. I appreciate you. Forgive me, y'all. All right, so listen, you just got back home from Sam's. Did you pick me up some of the grapes, the cotton candy grapes that they have on sale, Mother? I need those in my life. Right. Our Sam's Club is out of them. Of course, our Sam's Club is out of everything because I do believe that the people in my neighborhood are preppers. Shall these folks be buying up everything? Sam's can't keep nothing on the shelf, and neither can the Walmart, but whatever. No, not five people in the chat, honey. No, ma'am. Seven people, total, but a great majority of them are in the clouds and the shrubbery. Hey, y'all, hey, please smash the like button and welcome. Hey, Choco Chip, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And the same to you, Cindy White. Welcome, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here as well. All right, so listen, y'all, we getting ready to start a deeper love inside. Now, this is the Porsche Santiaga story. Now, I'm gonna just tell y'all right out the gate. This book is 51 chapters plus a dedication and an after story. Okay. Gonna give it all to you. Listen, that's what I told him. Anyway, stop my business. My point is, it's a lot of reading. So that's why I put 8 chapters today. So y'all gonna have to excuse me because I will be taking my potty breaks. Y'all know I drink a gallon of water a day. Okay. So that's going to happen. I will play y'all a little music so y'all won't be sitting here bored while I go, and pay a water bill. And wash my hands real good, okay? Because I'm not nasty. All right. So that part. So I because I don't want us to take forever to get through this. I really don't. Hell, I may come back this evening and do some more. I think I said I'm doing 1 through 8 today in this video. I may come back and do some more simply because this book is so long and I want to get through it, right? So that part. Hey, Kennedy Monroe, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. It just depends on how I feel. So Kennedy said, hi, all. Happy Mother's Day. I'm listening as I make this. Oh, you're making a charcuterie board for your mother tomorrow. That's wonderful. Still working on this audio text. Loving these books. All right. All right. Well, listen, that's wonderful. I like that. Wonderful. As Madea says, that's wonderful. Well, thank you for being here, Kennedy. I appreciate you, darling. Welcome, welcome. Oh, that was when you mentioned only three of us. Well, yeah, that was I only saw three people in the you did, child. Yeah, it was only you. It was me, you, and Black Diamond. That was it, baby. Oh, you didn't check on the grapes? It's okay. Yeah, they're called cotton candy grapes. They're seedless, which we really aren't supposed to be eating, because that is indicative of them being genetically modified. Right. I don't think I had a seedless grape, not a seedless green grape, and I don't know how long, child. Probably since 1980. Yeah, it's been about that long. That's why if they don't I mean a seeded green grape, all they have now are the ones that are seedless. And we're not supposed to eat those, but child, listen, I know you're lying. I got to have a grape or two, okay? All right. So Bikini said, you will entertain me while I'm doing my hair. Okay, well, that's cool too. All right, so listen, I have my coffee, thanks to my dear butler. I have had my shower. I am all fresh and clean after the afternoon delight, child. And listen, I have my water, which I will be drinking while I'm talking to you all, because I got to get through my gallon, right? I have 4 bottles left to drink, right? That is just absolutely delicious. All right, so let's get to getting here. I was trying to give people a little more time to get in the room because, you know, they like to run up in here like they ain't known that I was coming back, right? They like to run up in here like they didn't know that we were going to read the book, like they didn't know that I had set the dig up already. So I'm trying to give them a couple more minutes, but listen, I'm not about to wait all day because it's 4:13 here. And if y'all talking about me coming back, I know you lying. Gonna be sitting up here waiting all day. Do you show up to work late like this? Is that what y'all do? You show up to work late? Probably. All right, so let's get to getting here. I'm sorry, I can't. Maybe I should give them another minute, huh? They probably speeding down the highway trying to get home, child. Running late. Listen, I always am so considerate of other people, and they just really don't give a good damn about me. They really don't. They don't care, child. Oh, okay, mother. So this is the last book that you have on your Kindle tab. Okay, so you have all of the midnight books in hardback. Okay. So I don't know if I'm gonna read her we'll talk about that later. 'Cause I think I want to leave her for a little bit and go to gather together, mother. I really do want to do that. I think that's what I want to do. What you think about that? I think I want to do. I think the people would enjoy that. I really do. After this book, of course. But I mean, it's a book. You know, they can always click off if they don't like it. And then maybe we come back to midnight after that. You know, when we need a little gangster in our lives. All right, so let's get started with A Deeper Love Inside. Let me grab my pen so that I can keep the I like to try to keep the because this thing is supposed to do automatic chapters, y'all, but guess what? It doesn't. It doesn't do it. So I actually have an actual tablet. YouTube is supposed to do it automatic, but whatever. So I'm gonna keep I'll keep the things and do my own little timestamp so people oh, you'll be sitting here? All right. Okay, good. That's good to know, and I appreciate that. All right, so we are going to get started at the 16-minute mark, okay? So chapter one is 16 minutes in. All right. Well, the dedication actually is 16 minutes. Shit. Let me write that down. All right, here we go. Dedication. To all of the children and young ones who feel unloved, unprotected, without guidance, or who have been abandoned. If no adult has ever apologized to you, please allow me to be the first. To all of the real-life Winters who believed in something false and the real-life Porsches, Lexuses, and Mercedes snatched up by social services and trapped in group homes or foster care, or who have become parts of families with whom they share no blood relation. I apologize not out of pity for you, but out of pure love, the ingredients that each of you needed in the first place. Remember that whatever your circumstances, you are still responsible for yourself and your choices. You may be young, but you are not powerless. Speak up, speak out, read, study, learn, build, and resist injustice. Above all of the hurt, pain, and corruption, there is still a maker of your soul to whom you can direct your prayers and seek guidance. No matter what others may do, make sure you do what is right and true. Have faith. All of your faithful efforts, discipline, and hard work will be rewarded. All right, so that was the dedication. So chapter one will start at 1730. Not every bitch is a queen. Most chicks are just regular. Most of them know it and accept it, as long as nobody points it out. A queen is authentic, not because she says so, just because she is. A queen doesn't have to say nothing. Everybody can see it and feel it, too. A bunch of bootleg girls been trying to come up. That's what they're supposed to try and do. But their borrowed, stolen style sucks because it's borrowed and stolen. A queen knows who she is inside and out. She wouldn't imitate anybody else. In fact, she creates original styles, waits for the bootleg bitches to catch on and copy, then switches, making their heads spin, eyes roll, and their short money pile disappear. I'm gonna tell you what I hate first. Then I'm gonna tell you what I love. Every word that I say is straight because I don't have no time to play with you. The majority of my time is spent stacking my status and plotting to get back my stuff. I hate conceited girls. They're played out. You may think that I'm one of them, but there's a difference between conceit and quality, or should I say conceit and truth. Matter of fact, some of the ugliest females I know are conceited. We living at a point where this shit is all mixed up on purpose. The ugly ones pretend they look good when everything they got is cheap and fake, including their personalities. The pretty ones play themselves down because jealousy is more realer than the air we suck in and blow back out. I, Porsche L. Santiaga, am a real pretty bitch. I try my best to stay in my lane and mind my own business to keep all the envious ones from talking shit, mobbing up, and jumping me. It isn't easy being the sister of a queen. Naturally, I look up to her, but still, I gotta be me. Imitation gets no respect. I would never live my life trying to look like or be someone else. Regarding my sister, Winter Santiaga, every day for 8 years, I had my big brown eyes trained on her. She's a queen, not because she's beautiful, which is automatic, not because she's a badass with endless styles and personality, not because she's my older sister, my mother's best friend, and my father's most loved jewel, None of those are the reason. Ricky Santiaga has four daughters. His firstborn, Winter, seemed to have occupied his whole heart. My handsome father was not to blame. Everyone loved her. When she was in a crowded room, everyone was looking her way or trying to stand or sit right beside her. Even in our home, she soaked up all the love as though she were the only child, but she wasn't the only child. Me, I'm the middle daughter. Maybe you know a little something about how that goes. Everyone's eyes were either on the oldest daughter because her young figure was ripe and ready, her eyes so mischievous and her face so feminine and perfect that they were all scared she might get pregnant. Or their eyes would be on the youngest because they are the babies and they might get hurt. The middle girl is too young to be fucking and too old to be falling down, so everyone forgets where she is and what she's doing. I got mixed feelings about being invisible. There are benefits, I can't lie, but sometimes, quietly, I was yearning for Papa and Mama to pay attention to me simply because their love for me was as true and as strong as my love for each of them. I didn't want to have to beg them for love. I didn't like the idea of having to be annoying to get attention or having to make a dramatic or phony scene. I hate pretense. Winter was a queen in my younger eyes because she didn't have to ask for love, but she was always receiving it. When she did receive it, no one cared if she returned it. They loved her whether she loved them back or not. She didn't seek attention. She commanded it. Winter had the best of everything without working or obeying. Her friends, who were coming and calling constantly, surrounded my sister. Even my young friends wanted to grow up to be Winter. My old aunties wished they could be young again, only to try to look and live like Winter. More than that, in my younger eyes, Winter was above pain and punishment, and mostly no one else in the world can claim that. In the chaos of any crisis, she walked in looking good, stylish, clean, and untouched. She'd shift her pretty eyes right and then to the left and come up with the swiftest plan, which only she knew the details of. I was home when they arrested my father. Winter wasn't. I was left at home when they arrested my mother. Winter wasn't. I was home when the kidnappers, social services, snatched up me, Lexi, and Mercedes. Winter wasn't. We three sisters were separated and trapped in the system. Winter wasn't. In fact, Winter and Mama came to check me one time at a state supervised visit where I was being held and watched over by the kidnappers. When they walked in, my beautiful mama's head was shaved bald. Shocked for some seconds, I still wanted to hug her and have her hug me back tight enough to signal to me silently that she knew that this shit was all wrong, that she would take me back home with her. Mama's eyes were filled with rage and sorrow. Winter looked rich. She was sparkling and free, like she had a thousand little light bulbs outlining her entire body. Her caramel colored skin was glowing. Her hair was fresh, soft, long, and second only to her pretty face. She looked unbreakable, untouched, and unaffected. Then it was confirmed in my eyes on that exact day that Winter was straight royalty above anyone else who suffered on a regular, including now my mama and me. That so-called visit was the first time I saw my mother and sister after being took in, and the last time I saw both of them together ever again. I miss Mama so much I ache, like when you have vomited to the end and there's nothing else to throw up, only a thick yellow fluid comes out that one nurse said is called bile. Have you ever been in the emergency room strapped to a bed screaming out Mama 156 times, Papa 77 times, and I want to go home 33 times? As for Papa, 6'1, light skinned, strong, and suave, with not even a teaspoon of bitch in him, no man on earth is better than him. Mama is like a cup of hot chocolate on a freezing morning. Papa is like a cup of black tea with a whole lot of heavy cream mixed in. Dark and light, they complemented one another. Winter was the best parts of both of them, all in one. I love her, and fuck anybody else who doesn't, no matter his or her reason. Listen when I tell you, I am 100% loyalty. If you can count, you know that there's nothing left over from that. Unique, I know I'm different from her, but we sisters. We're full blood related, so I'm royal. I inherited these looks like winter and mama. My beauty is undeniable, captivating, and offensive to many. No, I'm not light skinned. Stop that silly shit, as if there is only one shade to be deeply admired. I'm honey brown like an expensive Godiva that can only be purchased in a specialty shop. My brown gold eyes are outlined with a thin black line that circles around the pupil like an exotic bird. When people first notice them, they pause and look again. Every day I fight, not because of anything I did, just because of who I am naturally. I fight young, angry bitches because they wish they had these same eyes and can't get comfortable until they poke mine out. My skin is flawless, like satin or an unaffordable diamond. I'm a dancer. Not a stuck-up ballerina or a fucking stripper. Back on our I hate that. Back on our Bed-Stuy Brooklyn block, I had an all-girls dance crew. We used to rock. We even won first place at our block party over some girls that was older than us. People were amazed at how our young bodies could bend and move, flow, bounce, and shake like we knew shit we couldn't possibly have known, and experience shit that none of us had experienced. Yet. We tore it up, moving to a Rob-based throwback titled It Takes Two. That night, Mama placed her hands on my hips and said I would grow up to be her moneymaker. I liked the feeling that I was doing something that made Mama look my way for more than a few moments and believe in me. My hair was black. It grew from my own scalp and lays on my back. Mama says it's long because I'm loved. She says other bitches don't know or don't want to keep their daughter's hair clean, oiled, combed, conditioned, and clipped. Back then, Mama would say, if you see a bald bitch, she's unloved. Or she cut her hair off because she don't want to be loved. Or she cut it off because she ran up on some rotten love. Me, I know mine is real nice, but I don't worship my hair. I keep it neat and never throw it in nobody's face. Apparently, that ain't enough. In a 2-year stretch, I had 17 fights. 9 of them were brawls over hair with half bald bitches with homemade weapons. I fought a conceited ugly girl named Cha-Cha 4 out of the 9 hair fights. In arts and crafts class, I grabbed the one pair of scissors shared by 20 girls and chained to the desktop and cut off my hair and gave it to her so she could stop fucking sweating me. She wore my hair braided into single box braids on her head the next day. I didn't say anything to her. I had gotten comfortable with my shortcut overnight. Then she got mad because I wasn't mad, so she fought me again. The authorities, that's what we call them, they lock me up in isolation for fighting. Every time they act like they don't know what the fight is all about. Every time they act like we 50-50 involved in the fight when they know damn well that chick hates herself and is gonna fight till somebody kills her and puts her out of her misery. Even with my wrists locked and my ankles chained, headed to isolation, I don't react. They release me into that little space butt naked. Then I dance. Repetition makes my legs beautiful, strong, and tight. I don't eat, so I don't have no body fat. I taught myself to accept hunger because people try to use it against you when they think they got something you really need, even if it's only a sandwich. I dance until I'm drenched. The music plays in my head, sounding crisp like it did back in Brooklyn. I stop when I collapse. Then I wake up in another wig with a tube in my arm and a bad breath nurse faking concern and whispering something like, "You could have died last night." I close my eyes and wish I had enough fluids in my mouth to spit on her just to clear my throat. When they would bring me back into the population, mixed with the rest of the bitches, 522 of them to be exact, I'd see most of the girls from my section gasp like they seen a ghost. I know certain ones of them won't be happy until they slit my perfect skin open or at least put a permanent stamp on it. That's why I plot. In one of the monthly head sessions, they make us have one of my enemies told the therapist that she fights me because I think I'm better. I told her she fights me because she thinks I'm better. These regular bitches don't get it. It's not my hair or eyes or legs or none of that bullshit that makes me who I am. Plain and simple. It's that I'm Porsche L. Santiaga, born rich. My daddy was rich. My mama was rich. My sisters were rich. I'm not gonna act like a regular bitch when I was born royal. They never had nothing, so they don't know no better. They got nothing to miss. I had a queen-size bed when I was 7 years old. Even before then, back in Brooklyn at my sister's 16th birthday celebration at Moe's, in the dead of the winter season, my whole family was styling. I rocked a three-quarter mink and mink earmuffs and a mink muffler instead of gloves. I have a mother who taught me the difference between everything cheap and high quality. I had three sisters, all dimes, living swolled in a beautiful Long Island palace. The last thing my papa promised me was a pony so I could trot around our property. It's the police who are the criminals, kidnappers, and thieves. The authorities know the deal. They all in it together. That's why I jammed the sharpened number two pencil in my caseworker's neck as she was driving me in her state-owned vehicle. She tried to say something slick about my family, about winter in particular. I don't play that shit. Family sticks together. If a bitch believed she could say something rude about a Santiaga out loud and in my face, I obviously wasn't on my J-O-B. Now, I don't know if I was trying to kill her. I just wanted the bitch to pay attention to what I had been telling her for many months. I am Portia L. Santiago, sister to Winter Santiago, the twins Lexus and Mercedes Santiago. Brooklyn born, we chill now in a Long Island mansion. Stop driving me around and dropping me off to the broke, broken, perverted, ugly ass foster care providers and introducing me to strangers who want to pretend to be my parents. I don't pretend at nothing. I don't like fake shit. Take me home. I have a house and a family. I told her clearly in a respectful tone. I recited to her my exact Long Island address. You shouldn't look up to a girl like Winter, even though she is your real sister, the bitch said one autumn morning when I was seated and trapped in the back seat of her state vehicle, where I had been seated and trapped many times. She must have felt good and big about herself with her files filled up with dirty talk about my real life and her folded newspaper that must have reported some lies that she decided to believe. So she started saying something foul. Winter, my caseworker said, referring to my well-loved sister. My caseworker is paralyzed now. So she got a lot of time to sit still and think about all the lies she'd been telling little kids about taking them to live in a better place, in better circumstances. She knew what the fuck was up. She'd say and do anything, no matter how evil it was, as long as they paid her to do it. She'd drop me off anywhere, including hell, and leave me with anyone, including the motherfucking devil, even if she knew for sure I was in serious danger. As long as that was the address printed on her paper, she'd leave me without looking back. So they got me locked up in juvie. It's better than playing house. Everything is clear in here, the way I prefer things to be. No one is pretending to love me or the rest of us. We damn sure ain't pretending to love them or each other. In here, there's only friends and enemies, no in between. All right. So that is the end of chapter one. All right, let me speak to anybody else who may have come in. Hey, Evil Lynn, that is my super sniper in the ghillie suit up top. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, wings and mambo sauce. Well, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hello, hostess, mods, and chat. I didn't know about this book. I have to catch up. All right. I know, I'm good. I'm good, mother. Not yet, not yet. Probably after this next chapter. So, but yeah, no, I'm good right now. All right, chapter two. I overheard my papa, Ricky Santiago, say, "A good hustle starts with a tight team." All right, this is 34 minutes. I'm sorry, y'all. I had to write that down. I almost forgot. All right, I got mine. We call ourselves the gutter girls because one of our teachers said we act like we come from the gutter. I didn't feel fucked up about the gutter thing. I figured if a rich bitch dropped a diamond in the sewer, Even if it got covered with shit and slime and trampled on by mice and rats, if someone discovered it 10 years later, they'd easily clean it off and it would still be worth major paper, probably even more than it was back when it first got dropped. I turned that gutter shit around, made it pop, two upside down lowercase interlocking G's. When we got our shit together, we would capitalize it, turn it right side up like Gucci. When I first formed the little seven chick clique, I took the leftover, looked out, I'm sorry, I took the leftover, looked over, overlooked chicks from the C-section and gave them a do-over. My first recruit was a fat, stinky girl. Her friends called her Greedy Gail. Her enemies called her Pig. I checked how she got a lot of letters and even a box of goodies from home once a month and seemed to have a big budget at the commissary. While everyone else took the time to tease her, I approached her to strike a deal. I disregarded her funk and went right into it. I called her by her true name, Gail, and kept it polite on purpose. Do you like music? I asked her. She looked like she wasn't used to nobody being nice. After a pause, she said, a little bit. You want to dance with me on the yard? I asked her. We can do a dance workout together. It will make you feel good and look good too, I said. I could tell she was thinking about it, so I pressed her some more. You have a pretty face. You might as well match it all up, I said. She seemed to like the way I put it, taking the edge off. Not on the yard, because everybody be staring, Gail said. Okay, then we'll do it in the dorm at night in our section, starting tonight. I compromised for her. Then I eased her into purchasing a Department of Corrections radio and cassette player for $39.99. We gotta control the beat, I told her. I help you, you help me. How could I help you? She asked, like it wasn't possible, like she thought I was already perfect. Just put in the work for the first 2 weeks. We'll do you first, then me, I said. She agreed. I put up with her farting every time she lifted her fat legs and even when she bent over to try and touch her toes. In a short time, in addition to the workout, I put her on a diet. Convincing her that I was helping her resist temptation, I took over her care box and her commissary, selling and trading her goods and candies on the low for half the price the authorities charged. It was easy for me because I didn't pay for nothing in the first place. My hustle was so sweet that it tipped off the sugar wars in the young section dormitory where we was locked. I made a name for myself. The more sugar schemes I invented, the more rules the authorities invented. The more they punished and stressed us young girls, the more the demand for my discount sugars increased. The more sugar everybody ate, the more tempers flared and fists began flying. I wanted to be known for making money and moves, not for brawling. Fighting was an interruption to my business, but the better my business, the more the fighting came along with it. Truthfully speaking, we didn't have no Grants or Benjamins on lockup. I made paper money in arts and crafts, and I made my section believe in it, work for it, trade and pay for things that we all should have had anyway, but that the authorities didn't provide, charging us for it instead. They knew that shit was fucked up for girls like me who didn't receive no letters or visits and had no one placing even one piece of copper on my commissary. As Gail dropped the pounds, she grew more confident. I taught her to stop munching up the product and to work out even harder. She liked me. I didn't just talk shit. I worked out beside her and never let her see me laugh at her flaws. When she wanted to skip a night of working out, I refused. I held her feet down for sit-ups and cheered her on when she made the smallest improvement. Music is influence. We picked up four more chicks from our section, all strange but drawn in by the music and dance workout, as well as the results of seeing Gail's recovery. When she got down to an attractive size and her face that had been buried under layers of fat got revealed, she became ruthless and loyal. If I got in a fight, she'd handle the business while I was trapped down in isolation. Now, she fought on my side along with five other girls I recruited. Now that Gail looked decent, I liked her for truth. Big, sloppy, stinky girls can't get no respect because more than anybody else with a problem, theirs is the first thing you'll see and smell. So everybody uses it against them. And that's the end of chapter two. All right. All right, let me see what y'all are saying. All right, so Mother said, good, I will go then as well. All right, so that's the end of chapter two. All right, so I'm gonna go and make use of the facilities, and I will be right back, you guys. Give me one second. Thank you for your patience and welcome back. All right, so Bikini said, now reading chapter two. Okay, thank you, Bikini. All right, thank you, Bikini. All right. Oh, Mother said, Dennis, you could say fuck up. Yes. All right, so I did. We went to go pee. All right, yes, we are reading A Deeper Love Inside, chapters 1 through 8 by Sister Souljah. Yes, indeed. Thank you, Bikini. Just a super moderator. Yes, indeed. Thank you for that. All right. So Mother said, hold up, wait a minute. Let me get back in it. Hey, okay. All right. Okay. Well, I hope y'all are enjoying it so far. I like the book. Like I said, it's just not a winter Santiaga type deal. But it's still good. It is. It's still good. So there's that part. All right. So at 43 minutes and 30 seconds, chapter three. She's a white girl. I don't look up to her because of that. But I don't look down on her either. I already told you, I don't play the skin color game. Riot. She said, introducing herself to me in the slop house, which is what I call the cafeteria at Juvie Lockdown. Riot? I repeated. Yeah, like when shit is so fucked up and you can't take it no more, so you start brawling, setting shit on fire, blowing shit up. She gave a Jolly Rancher green-eyed stare into my eyes. Her lips were watermelon red. I didn't crack a smile. There was a pause. Looking away and up towards the ceiling, she continued. The authorities hate my name, but it's the name my parents named me. It's on my birth certificate. It's official. What do you want? I asked her as I was checking her out. I could tell from her hairstyle she had at least one ghetto chick for a friend. Her hair was black. It was one thick and pretty cornrow that started at the center of her head and swirled around in circles until it finally dropped down and dangled over her right shoulder. It was frizzy, like she had gotten it braided 3 days back. I could tell that unbraided, her hair was crazy long. She was smart to rock it like that, laying tight on her scalp, because if she were fighting someone younger like me, a furious lightweight who wasn't naturally a fighter and needed a way to protect myself, I would take long, loose hair and choke her with it, the same way the young ones tried to do me when I first got locked. "You look hungry," Riot said. She was right, but she looked hungry too. Her face was lean, like a supermodel. Her teeth, the tops and bottom, were not crooked or buck or bent. They were all white and lined up in a perfect row. "What do you eat? You gotta eat something to stay alive, right?" she asked me, and I'm sorry, she asked me as though she were my real life big sister. "What do you eat?" I threw the question right back at her. Didn't like to be questioned. She smiled. "Apples, oranges, bananas. If I'm lucky, a few nuts and raisins. I got a girl who works in the kitchen and a girl who does a shift at the commissary, so I get mine," Riot said confidently, not bragging, but more like she was trying to offer me something. That's how it goes up in here. You gotta watch and listen for the slightest twist of the tongue so none of these slick ass girls could front like you agreed to something you didn't agree to or accept. I couldn't and wouldn't front. I was surviving on sugar and trained myself to be satisfied for hours off of the flavor from a lifesaver. Dinner would be something big like Twizzlers or cheese doodles. Beneath my red juvie jumper, there was zero body fat. Before I could ignore or answer her questions, my belly started churning and a noise came out. Our eyes locked. Then we both broke out and laughed. I marked that down in my mind. It was my first true smile since getting tooken. A smile that led to real laughter. After that, the feeling between us loosened up some. She started telling me her dope ass story. That's how me and her met, got tight, and got ganged up. Riot's parents owned a marijuana farm in upstate New York. I don't know how big an acre is, but she said she had a 50-acre property. Riot got here on lockdown before me. She said she murdered a man. That made me feel closer to her because I figured she was strong, or at least that she would defend herself, and I like that. No one believed more than me that there are some who definitely deserve it. She said she tagged me because she noticed I wasn't eating the shit they served, which meant I was smart and unlike the robots, which is what she called most of the other young inmates. Riot says she knows how to grow real food. Her family had apple trees, cornfields, tomato and lettuce patches, and an herb garden. She claims she even knew how to make maple syrup from a tree. My mind envisioned a stack of silver dollar pancakes dripping in syrup. I live not too far from here, 2 hours to the west in quiet country. That's how she described her place. So quiet you could hear mosquitoes, bees, crickets, and snake bellies sliding through the tall grass, or even the wind pushing around, depending on the season. I pictured a serpent in my head. "I'm not afraid of snakes," Riot said. "I used to lie in the grass right beside them and swim in the lake with the water moccasins." She used her hand and motioned a snake movement. It looked like she was remembering something that felt good to her. "I was lying in the long grass on my back late summer when I saw those helicopters." That's what she called them. Then she pointed to the sky. I didn't panic. I just counted and watched them flutter in. "Our farm field workers dropped down and laid low like locusts," she said, gesturing dramatically. That was their first time also seeing helicopters, that's what she called them, over my parents' place. They were still flat on their bellies after the copters had flown for half an hour before fluttering out. Riot paused like she was remembering it too clearly and waiting with her workers. Some workers didn't show back up the next day. The workers who did show, my dad paid them double. He believed in profit sharing, worked the land the same as if he wasn't the owner, when he was. He hated the word boss, didn't answer anyone who used it. He said, "Workers United are more powerful than any boss, any state, or any authority." My mom wasn't the agreeing type, but she agreed with my dad. My mom hated the words boss, authority, state, and government. The murder Riot committed and the weed farm she came from caught my attention. When she would talk some sentences I didn't understand or give a fuck about, I just listened to the feeling of her storytelling and watched the intense and swift way she switched her face gestures. Oddly, it felt like her words were filling my belly with a real meal, temporarily at least, and they were flooding my mind with movie pictures. I thought about how I had not seen even one film since I was 7. Riot said her parents drove a lavender station wagon with huge yellow daisies painted on. I thought to myself, who would buy that shit if they were getting guap? Riot said her parents were caked up, but didn't care about fashion and money. Mom and dad were in love with freedom, the land, the soil, the animals, and people. She said her whole family was all vegetarians, yet they had 4 pet pigs who wasn't locked up or fenced in and roamed around a big area freely. I could tell each one of them from the other, and they each had names. Weed, Seed, Smoke, and Puff, she said, pulling a finger as she counted them out. We treated them like people, she smiled, remembering. Seriously, they each had different personalities, and I hope you know for sure that I'm not making none of this up. You like animals? I asked. Or I'm sorry, you like animals? She asked me. I smiled, remembering myself. Something like that, I said, snatching my smile back. I didn't want anyone in here to know my likes and dislikes. I knew they would use that shit against me. But I had obviously already given that one fact away by mistake. Then you would love Ganja, my colt. He's incredible, Riot said. How fast is he? I asked curiously. He could outrun the bullets fired from the tower, Riot answered, referring to the rumored guards who, everyone said, stood watch from way up high over the lockup facility for violent juvenile girls, where we are both prisoners. The sky guards were the threat. Make one wrong move and they would riddle our little bodies with bullets. None of us saw them, though. At least I didn't. But I didn't doubt that they were up there lurking. Ganja's faster than my brother's horse. Sensimilia, Riot added. I pictured pretty ponies galloping in my mind. I liked the way Riot put her words, like she wasn't afraid of shit. I liked that she was rich. Even if her people didn't know how to spend or wear it right, at least they had a family, and the pictures in my mind said they were happy. Have you ever seen a diamond needle? She asked out of nowhere. I had seen plenty of diamonds. Winter had 50 princess cut diamonds in her tennis bracelet and 125 in the matching necklace. I counted them secretly, since I wasn't allowed to touch her jewelry or mama's and wasn't scheduled to get my own diamond set until I turned 16. I shined Winter's diamonds after I tried them on and before I placed them back on the black velvet and placed them exactly where they were hidden in her room before I found them. Diamond needles are insects with beautiful wings, Riot said. They look like a mix between a dragonfly and a honeybee. That's what the helicopters look like the second time they showed way up in the sky, a swarm of diamond needles dancing behind swollen clouds on a rainless gray day. Our field workers scattered like ants in all directions. I crawled into my hiding place like my parents told me and my brother to do if the copters ever returned, she said, and I felt in my gut that something real bad was about to happen in Riot's story. Unlike the previous time, the copters cut their way through the clouds and actually landed on our land. Her fingers were fluttering in the jumpy motion of the helicopter's landing. I glanced at the guards. In here, if any of us keep using our fingers, they swear we gang signaling. As Riot described the raid on her property, pictures and sounds of the Nassau County police geared up and guns drawn flashed through my mind from the night they swooped down and barged in on my family. They smirked smiles as they cut open our leather sofas and love chairs, broke vases and dishes, jerked down pictures from walls, and pulled furs and fashions out of our closets, capturing and cuffing my handsome and fashionable father, who was dressed in a thick black suede V-neck leisure suit and sporting black Gucci loafers, wasn't enough for them. They seemed to want to destroy his success and lessen him some in our eyes. Jealous motherfuckers, I whispered under my breath before I turned back and I'm sorry, before I tuned back into the story Riot was telling. Ragweed and gunpowder, that's all I could smell. I didn't move. I was frozen by the sounds of war, Riot said, and struck a frozen, frightened pose. I knew my dad and mom were firing back, After all, the feds were the intruders. The 50 acres and all of our animals were our private property, bought and paid for in full by my parents. A slophouse guard patrolled by our table. He knew it was unusual for an older girl to be sitting with a young one. Besides, I was in my red jumper, so he would have been watching closely anyway. Red jumper meant violence. Riot glanced at him. You know, a shootout is nothing like what you see on television. The speakers in your TV set can't capture the deafening noise or the thickening of the air or the scent of flesh ripped open and guts and blood bursting and pouring out till there's nothing left except for dark stains. Riot described the murder of her parents, who were killed defending their freedom, their property, family, and hard work. They went out the right way. That's what they would say. Fuck a government that wants to tell you what you can't grow on your property and still charge you property taxes for property you already paid for, she said, imitating what I guessed was either her mother's or father's words. Live free or die fighting. That's our thing. She put up two fingers like a peace sign, but then put her fingers to her lips, pretending like she was smoking a cigarette, but she wasn't. There's no smoking allowed in juvie lockdown. None of us are over 16. Riot and her brother stayed still for days in an underground bunker their father had built long ago. We had books, blankets, a toolbox, and candles, two flashlights, a limited supply of water, a fruit basket, a first aid kit, flares, emergency items, and canned beans, dry snacks, and of course, our guns. When the intruders, cars, trucks, sirens, and voices had ceased for more than 48 hours, we climbed out, she said. It wasn't long before their head count confirmed what our hearts couldn't handle, but that they had already suspected. Not only their parents' bloodied bodies had been removed, but their animals had been seized also. They had heard their cries, their feet, and their voices from the underground. It sounded so sick, I forced myself to forget it. Otherwise, it would have kept replaying in my head. We felt helpless, like cowards. My brother and I both fought and held one another back from coming out of the bunker like our parents told us not to do. Riot's face revealed her regrets. My collie named Clyde had been taken and his wife Bonnie. We loved our dogs. We were all family. Riot spoke as though dogs could actually be married. I wanted to laugh at that, but from her look, she was dead serious and still hurting. So I didn't. Her and her brother scrubbed up, spilled blood, and continued to live on their land. The harvest had brought us plenty of fruits and vegetables. We could have lived off of just the apples and corn alone. Riot said that they knew that the two of them were being left alone. Being left alone was only temporary. The authorities, school principal, and maybe even friends or neighbors would come looking for them. How could two children just disappear without a trace? Me and my brother was always the best at hide and seek. We used to play it with the workers' children on some weekends when they'd show up. One autumn, we were playing the most wicked game of hide and seek ever. It dragged on from sun up to sundown when their parents were done for the day. No one knew the property better than us. Riot had her hands on her hips now, looking fully confident. After our parents were murdered, it was 3 months before Con Ed cut off our electricity, 3.5 months before Ma Bell shut down our phones. The telephones didn't matter. We didn't make or take no calls and treated the phones like a trap. We listened to it ring 1, 2, 7, 8 times. We also rarely used the power and tried to accomplish everything in the daylight. Lights could be seen by any curious neighbor. Lucky for us, out in quiet country, neighbors were more than a mile away on both sides. We only had to be on the watch for the extra curious ones, who now treated our place like an exciting stop on a crime horror tour, or the land-thieving realtors who had posted a for sale sign at the beginning of our land and then at the end, she said. The helicopter raid had taken place in August. When the power finally shut off in November, we sparked up the backup generator that my parents had used many times in the furious country storm weather. We had gasoline stored, but not enough for more than 2 weeks' worth. So we used it sparingly. We put all our blankets in one pile and slept there together underneath them all. We came close to freezing to death, but luckily not both at the same time. When I got sick, my brother healed me. When he was sick, I healed him. We survived the coldest winter ever, my brother and me. Riot began howling quietly with her hands cuffed around each side of her mouth. When the wolves began howling and the puppies that Bonnie and Clyde had cleverly hidden and left behind went to barking, and the cans began rattling from the tripwire that my brother laid on the road as a warning to us. We were both at different places on the property. My brother was out in the fields putting down some seeds. I was coming from around the back of our house, Wyatt's face turned angry. As the stranger's car rolled cautiously up our pebble dirt road, I saw his car door first, and then his license plate. The plates were marked with two of the words that our parents hated most, state and government. The state worker man couldn't see Riot. Riot saw him. She said she read the words on the side of his car, Bureau of Child Welfare. All I could imagine was the guy trying to hurt or separate my brother from me. Her eyes were squinted now. I grabbed my rifle, shot one clean shot, one time, straight through his forehead. She gestured as though she was holding and aiming her rifle right there in the slop house. 6 days later, cops flooded our property and made another massive and thorough search, uncovering the murdered guy's buried body and the state vehicle parked behind closed doors inside our empty barn where some of our stolen animals would have been if they hadn't us. It was, she said, if they hadn't slaughtered them. She put her hands up halfway over her head. I got surrounded in the chicken coop where I was squatting, she said, finally smiling. I'm 10, I told the police. Don't shoot me. I'm only 10 years old. She pushed her hands up in the full surrender position. Riot was so lucky she was only 10 back then. We both knew that juvie was fucked up, but we both heard and believed that grown-up prison is much worse. At 14 years old, any girl up here in juvie can get transferred out to an adult facility without notice. 16 is the oldest anybody in here could be. In juvie, no girl turns 17. I'm asking you to be one of my sons, Riot said strangely. Sons, I repeated. It's obvious you're younger than me. I'm 13, Riot confided. I'm 10, I revealed. So, you be my son. I see you're always fighting. You are young and slim, but no matter how young, big, or small anyone is, one person can never win alone. I was thinking about her words and if they had any point or meaning to me. Heard you got beef with Cha-Cha, Riot said. What about it? I fight her. It ain't nothing. I shrug my shoulders. Cha-Cha's a robot. She gives the guards what they want. She starts fights and fucks up the flow. She gives them the excuse and the reason to clamp down on you and everybody in your section, she said. I was listening. Say yes, and you got a crew, Riot added. I was thinking. I already had a crew. The thing is, our crew is smarter than the robots. We don't act like stupid girls fighting over hair and boys and visits or dumb shit. We all girls who came from families with either land or money or both. She rubbed her fingers together, making the make money sign. We action figures, she gestured, like she was about to leap up from the table. We camouflage. She squatted back down and relaxed. We got plans and connections. We make moves. She pushed her face closer to mine. I'll turn 11 in July, I told her. I didn't want her thinking I was so young that she could rule over me. I'll turn 14 in July, she said, letting me know no matter what she had, 3 years over me either way. What you call your crew, I asked her. The Diamond Needles, she said softly, with an intense face that caused me to stare at her lips as she pronounced each word. We don't big up our name, wear tattoos or flash signs. We don't do the daily group up on the yard. We keep our mouths shut. If something is important, we send a message or a messenger with a kite. We don't do anything obvious. Like I said, we're smart. There are 10 of us. We each got a number in the order that we came together. What's your number? I asked her. One was all she said. If I come in, what do I get? I asked. An army, she said. Do you like music? I asked her, changing the subject on purpose. I could see it interrupted her thought flow some. Of course, she responded soft and swiftly. Name your favorite rapper and favorite group. Tupac Shakur, easily, she answered, like he was a king. My favorite group? Bone Thugs and Harmony, hands down. She was definite and excited herself just by reciting their group name. Enough questions, she said, turning suddenly serious. Are you in or out? If you're out, this is the last conversation you'll ever have with me. If you're in, I'll let you know the next move. She wasn't bluffing. I could feel it. We both already knew I was in. I liked her story. She wasn't a broke bitch, a broken down bully, hater, or a victim, and I wasn't either. I had nothing to lose. The gutter girls weren't going anywhere, and neither were me or Riot. We are all prisoners. I got one condition, I answered Riot after a long pause. My girl Siri got to be down with us. It's a two-for-one deal. Siri? Riot repeated. I don't know her. Point her out. She's right here, I pointed Siri out, seated beside me. Riot's eyes dashed one quick time like she didn't see Siri. Then she turned straight-faced and said, no problem. You'll both be my sons. And that's the end of chapter 3. All right, let me wet my whistle. All right, let me see what y'all are saying. Oh, you're here just to hear me, to hear me read the book. Okay. All right. Well, I'm glad you're here. Thank you. I appreciate you. Okay, so chapter 3 started at the 46-minute mark. Oh, child, I put 43 minutes and 30 seconds, child. I don't know. Oh, sensimilia is cannabis. Oh, we used to call it, what is it? Sesamillion or something, child. I don't know, child. Whatever. I have no idea, mother. Let me see. All right, so let's get on down with the next one. Are y'all enjoying it so far? I hope so, child. All right, so 106. Chapter 4. We met in the dark, Siri and me, almost 3 years ago. The first night that I got here, the worst night of my life, the last items that I owned that came from Porsche El Santiago's world and wardrobe were taken from me. My denim guest skirt and matching denim guest jacket, which Mama bought for me. My deep blue Mecca t-shirt and matching blue bobos. My tiger leather Louis Vuitton tiny handbag that matched my leather riding boots. At first, I didn't know who Louis Vuitton was. But Winter said he was an important man and that if I lost the handbag, she would punish me by making me wear a cheap bag for a week. And of course, for that week, I couldn't go out with her because she don't hang with girls who rock cheap bags or cheap footwear, even if they're blood related. I held on to that bag mostly because I always wanted to hang with Winter. Besides, she bought the bag and boots for me brand new. Her best friend, Natalie, only got to rock Winter's hand-me-downs. I sported the boots only on special occasions and kept it a secret when they became too tight. Now all of my shit was gone. Good thing they left me in my panties. Freezing, the floor was frozen. My freezing little body was flooded with goose pimples. The two lady guards handed me paper shoes and a baby blue jumper, all ugly. Don't get dressed yet. Step over there. One of them ran her palms over my naked skin. Her palms felt like sandpaper, made my goose pimples crawl. Mama said lady and soft were the same damn thing. Clean, soft hands, skin, and feet, she would say as she rubbed my little body with her special creams and lotions. Don't get dressed yet, the guard said again as she searched and surveyed my body. Then she ordered her partner to call for the doctor. I don't know why they sent her here so late, the other guard muttered and picked up the phone. I shivered and shook for an hour and 22 minutes till the doctor finally showed up. I got the feeling they left me there undressed, seated on a cold metal stool on purpose. The male doctor's hands were pink in his palms and were hairy on the flip side. His bushy eyebrows had dandruff, big enough to see, almost as big as snowflakes. His fingertips were cold. His metal thing that he placed on my flat 8-year-old chest was cold. His pointy thing he pushed in my ear holes was cold. He shoved a stick down my throat and pinned down my tongue. He shined bright thin beams of light into each of my pupils. Laying flat on a cold table, he hit my knees with a hammer. My leg jumped. Sit up, he ordered me. Hold out your hand, he said, ignoring my nervous fingertip shaking. He flipped my hand around and pricked me with a needle between my thumb and the finger right next to it. He squeezed my finger till my blood burst out the teeny tiny hole that he made. He did some quick moves, then wiped my blood away and band-aided it, as though he wasn't the one who had cut me in the first place. Lay down, he ordered again. When he said done, he dragged his hand down my body and touched lightly the front of my panties, light enough to pretend he didn't do it. I peed. Even when I squeezed my legs together, my warm piss wouldn't stop gushing out. It was the only warmth I felt in a room so cold my piss should have turned into piss sickles. You should have saved that for my cup, the doctor said, now holding a small plastic container in his right hand. Now that he wanted pee for me, none would come out. What had already come was leaking from the metal table to the floor. In a washroom big as the living room in the projects, on a cold floor that could have been made of ice blocks, one guard blast showered me with cold water. My lips trembled. Pick 'em up, she told me. She pulled a plastic bag out of her back pocket. I dropped my piss panties, the last item that actually belonged to me, inside of her plastic bag. She put a tie on it and tossed it. Get dressed, she ordered, offering me no towel to dry my drenched skin. From now on, walk on the right side of the line, she ordered. Her voice echoed in the dark hallway. Her shoes clicked out 43 steps. She stopped walking and clicking. Then she aimed her high-powered flashlight at my feet. My damp paper shoes were no protection against the frozen floor. Bed number 34, she said, swiftly swiping her bright beam of light only one time. I looked but couldn't catch sight of anything in that 1 second. She killed the light. I knew she was trying to slowly fill me with panic and fear. Move, she shouted, while sounding like she was acting like she was whispering. Probably if she wasn't pretending to whisper, her real voice would shake the walls. I took my first step at the first crack of her voice raising up again. Keep your hands and feet to yourself, she said forcefully, or else we'll lock you up in the basement by yourself. I could hear her hard shoes banging on the ice floor as she walked away. I squinted, looking into the blackness in front of me. I could hear breathing, but couldn't see much of nothing. Just piles of bodies beneath blankets. One thin blanket on each bed. Some had their blankets sloppy. Some were wrapped tight like mummies in a horror film. Up close, I saw one arm dangling from beneath the blanket. It looked creepy. Swiftly, I looked back when I realized the guard's shoe sound stopped clicking and banging. A door slammed shut. Not like a door in my Long Island house. It was the sound of a door made of steel so heavy that it couldn't ever be opened without a bulldozer. The guard left me with lights out. She wanted me to walk to bed number 34 in the dark, dark. She wanted me to feel certain that she and anybody dressed in the same uniform as her didn't give a fuck about me. I felt it. I knew it. I would remember it. Always. Music. I was recasting Michael Jackson's Thriller video in my mind. I didn't need no monsters or masks, werewolves or vampires. The people in here were scary enough. The bodies lying around beneath the blankets was like a graveyard scene. I was Michael Jackson. Not the frightened girl in the video. I slid out of those worthless paper shoes and started dancing my walk through the huge black room. My limbs were fluid like Michael's. My movements were bold like Brooklyn, musical and unafraid. My heart was banging out the fast bass beats of the Thriller song. As I danced, my body began to heat up. Even the soles of my feet became warm. I was up and down the rows comfortably now, even in the darkness. No one could see me or stop me. My dancing made my anger more powerful than my fears. My body began to sweat. Caught up in my movements, I lost track of where I had been standing in the first place and which direction the flashlight had pointed towards to get to my bed. As my chest heaved in and out and my heart still raced, one blanket raised up in the air. The body hidden beneath was floating like a ghost. The blanket was the only colorful crocheted blanket in the big room. When the hands popped out of each side, I saw glow-in-the-dark little lights. No, I saw glow-in-the-dark nail polish and little fingers waving to follow her. I was Michael, so she must have been the pretty girl in the video who was afraid, but still friendly. Follow me, she said. I did. She stopped at an open bed so suddenly that I bumped into her back. She giggled. I saw you first, she said. So, let's you and me be friends before the rest of these monsters wake up. Don't be afraid. You'll never like it being here, but you will get used to it. She sounded nice and didn't stink. She didn't try to say or do nothing slick. She wasn't bossy either. She touched my hand. On the bed, she lay down beside me. What's your name? She asked. Portia, I whispered, trying to get my lips close to her ear so no one else would hear. Pretty name, she said. I'm Siri. We're going to be best friends, she predicted. Do you like music? I asked her. I like you, she responded. That's how me and Siri met. That night, all I saw was white teeth and pretty fingers. I liked her because she liked me. She only spoke to me. She showed me things about the other girls that maybe I would have missed if she didn't say nothing at all. When two girls in a nearby bed were acting fly by speaking some language that no one else knew, Siri and me egged them. Then we made up our own language. We worked on it for my first 7 nights there at dinner time, since we both wasn't eating. We made up our own alphabet using our own symbols. Each symbol stood for a sound, just like each letter in English stands for a sound. We would write words and then sentences out of our symbols. If anyone found our notes, they would not know what we were discussing because they didn't know our code or symbols. That meant we could write curses or our secrets and fucked up things about the authorities. At first, we didn't figure out how to speak our secret language out loud, so we only wrote it down after waiting in line to use one of the three pencils available in the dorm. One time, when the authorities searched our stuff in our dorm, which didn't happen often, but once is more than enough, they found our paper stacks. When they looked at the pages with all kinds of neatly written symbols lined up in neat rows, they asked us, "What is this about?" We didn't answer, just shrugged our little shoulders. They stole our pages and never gave them back. One day, at my session with the psych, she showed them to me. I was surprised to see them, so I did have a reaction on my face. She started speaking to me in the aggravating sing-song voice that I hated more than I hated her. "Let's talk about this," the psychiatrist said, holding up a page and asking me to explain the meaning. I told her, "It's graffiti. Ever heard of that?" She smiled, that stiff smile that looked like her lips were stitched and held together by some strong string pulled tightly on the ends to make a fake smile curve. "No, not exactly," she answered. She was never able to admit that there was just some shit she didn't know. "It's just a bunch of pretty designs. Don't you think it looks pretty?" I asked her. She stared at the page, paused, and then said, "I'm the one asking the questions here." She was mad that she couldn't figure me out. She couldn't get comfortable with being outsmarted by the girls she thought were the lowest, dumbest, and most craziest little things ever. When we were around the girls on our dorm, especially the ones who were speaking their unknown language out loud, me and Siri would start speaking to each other in a foreign language that even we did not know. It made everyone pay attention to us. It made everyone want to know our language. We wouldn't tell them shit. They'd get extra red when we suddenly started laughing. We'd be like, "Yeah, we flipped it around on y'all bitches." That made them start to accuse us of shit that we had nothing to do with. They was just mad that we wasn't mad. They hated when a girl didn't need them, their clique, and their bullshit. I fought, but Siri didn't. I fought for her, took the punishments, and never snitched on anything she did or that we did together. She wasn't made for fighting. Siri was the only warmth in a cold, cold place. She was soft and loving. She was into fashion and looked like she belonged on a Benetton's ad, draped in expensive Angora or cashmere sweaters made of thick and colorful yarns. She wasn't a conceited bitch. She was quiet and exclusively mine. When I heard music in my mind, Siri would hum along with it. Hearing her hum was real soothing and different. I mean, I was in love with music of all kinds, especially songs that made me catch feelings or remember memories. I was used to hearing the beatbox, rhymes, and all types of voices and instruments. I didn't have no right name for it, but Siri was like a professional hummer. Her voice messaged or massaged me, even when it was beneath a breakbeat. She was the soundtrack to the film that I didn't want to be starring in, but was. No matter who else I met, fought, or maneuvered around with, me and Siri had been inseparable since we met in the cold, dark dorm. And that's the end of chapter 4. All right, so let me see what y'all are saying here. Hang on. Okay. So Choco Chip said, "Yes, I am." All right, so y'all just laughing, huh? Are y'all enjoying it? It's a little nippy, sir. All right, well, I'm glad you're in. Okay. All right, you guys. I hope you're enjoying. Can I get a little heat on this? because the air cooled it off. Thank you. I hope you guys are okay. Why do I put emphasis on the F word? I don't know. I don't know. I shall I put emphasis on all cuss words? I guess I don't know. But I guess if you say I put extra emphasis on it, maybe I do. I don't know. I just didn't. I never really paid attention to that fact. But okay. I don't know. Oh, sorry. I guess I never thought about it. I never thought about why I do it, or, you know. Mm-mm. Oh, okay. Yeah, I told you. Listen, I've been cussing for a long time. So I'm used to it. People got to get used to it. All right, chapter 5. Chair was cemented to the floor. Ankles chained to the chair in the library. I'm a little girl, but I'm wearing the red jumper again, which means I had a recent violent episode and a stay in isolation. Small, tight cell, barely big enough for one, which the guards called the bottom. Normally, my age group, all girls up to age 10, wear baby blue jail jumpers. But, oh God, no matter your age, if you fight or fight back, they call it violence. Violent girls of all ages, up till 16, because at 16 you can't stay here in this lockup no more, get locked in the bottom in a 10-foot by 10-foot cell, sometimes naked. No matter how long you're in isolation, when you get out, the guard hands you a red jumper and says, "Get dressed." For 2 weeks after being locked down in isolation, everywhere you go, either your ankles or wrists or both sets are chained and cuffed, while the other inmates are hands and foot free. Like everybody, I still had to go to class, but in each class, there were a few seats reserved for girls with ongoing behavior problems like me. All seats were already cemented to the floors, but the hot seats were equipped with ankle cuffs, so violent girls couldn't move left or right or even stand up straight. At the end of each class, a guard posted outside would remove the cuffs, escort me to the next class, and lock me in the same type of chair all over again. The authorities thought they were embarrassing us, violent girls, for fighting. The warden stayed preaching the nonviolent shit, like she had no idea what was really going on, who was sparking shit up, or how to stop it. She claimed that if we kept wilding, she would put through the order to build classes with cages, one student to a cage, like we were wildlife, not humans. We young ones always did and thought opposite from the warden and them. Wearing red in the eyes of many girls locked down boosted my status, got me props, high fives, and favors. Some who wouldn't speak to me before would try to get next to me when I was red, hoping my style and status would rub off on them. So those were the ones I yanked around like puppets. My eyes moved around the library, a space I had never been in before. I was searching for Riot. She sent me a kite asking me to meet up in here. She must have gotten red that I had got into another fight the day after I got ganged up with her. Although I wasn't sure if her angle was going to be that my fighting made me look bad or made her look bad. It didn't matter, though. I live in the C dorm with the bad young bitches. Riot lived in the B dorm with the 11 to 13s. Even though I had linked up with the Diamond Needles, I still had to hold it down in my dorm no matter what. The library was kind of empty, except for the librarian who was weaving in and out of shelves, pushing a wheel cart loaded down with all types of books. There were three inmates reading quietly, but all separate from one another, and an inmate who was seated behind the front desk. She caught my eyes more than the others. A beige tan jail jumper she was wearing, which meant she was aged 15 or 16. Puerto Rican, that's what she was. I could tell. Her butterscotch complexion and the tan jumper she wore were close in color. She cut her black hair short and had it style nice. I noticed how the older girls up in here try to keep that fashion flow. She had dark eyes and long lashes. Her eyes weren't big and round, but were wide and curved nicely. More than that, she was wearing gold earrings, small ones that didn't dangle, but the gold was real. It stood out to me, of course. How did she manage to have them when jewels were forbidden? How does she manage to wear them and anybody could see them and then look at themselves not having none to rock? She had clout, That was my conclusion. I exhaled, tired of waiting on riot. It didn't matter. I couldn't move, couldn't leave. Once I requested the library, I had to remain here and wait out the whole hour till the guard reappeared to release me. Butterscotch stood up. She was tall, not doofy tall or man tall, a nice height, like Winter. She was slim, but had that nice figure, the type that made men on my Brooklyn block call out, "Mommy, let me talk to you a minute." She was coming my way. Her strut was nice. Maybe 5.5 years from now, when my 8-year sentence is served out, I would have a strut more menient or more meaner than hers. "Can you read?" she asked me as she laid a book on my desktop. I didn't answer her. She was pretty, her voice was nice, and her tone wasn't shitty or bossy, but still she had insulted me. So fuck her. She strutted back to where she came from. Her question, "Can you read?" reminded me of Miss Jenkins, my first grade teacher. I learned my letters in kindergarten, but Miss Jenkins taught me to read. The first day of class, she said, "If you can't read or write, you can't do anything." We were all little and quiet, and if the rest of the kids were thinking like me, they were probably only half listening and dreaming of being at home with Mama. When I was little, whenever I wasn't at home, I always felt like I was missing out on something, maybe even something big. Miss Jenkins made herself clear. She taught us one sentence: "I will be responsible for myself." She made us each write it 100 times and repeat it 10 times and recite it on our own 5 times. Close to the end of our first day of first grade, she handed out a paper and gave us a quiz on our little lesson. She collected the papers 10 minutes after she handed them out. Then she gave us each someone else's paper to correct. Next, she sent us up to the blackboard in groups of 4. She said we were playing a game called Challenge. She called out a word. We had to write the word on the board swiftly. The winner was the student who wrote it on the board the fastest and who spelled the word correctly. Her teaching style jerked us out of our dreams and made us feel oppressed. As our long day with one teacher in one classroom came to an end, Miss Jenkins pulled out a tin can of goodies and gave every student who scored 100 on the quiz a foil-wrapped candy, like mini Reese's peanut butter cups or Hershey's chocolate kisses. She gave the winner of the challenge game an unusual and pretty pencil case that was see-through on one side with a slide-down cover. It was filled with decorated pencils and even a pencil sharpener. On the first day of first grade, Miss Jenkins made me want to win. Now I could get any kind of food or candy gift at home, of course. We lived in the projects, and we had everything to choose from because Papa kept us living and eating very well. But what Miss Jenkins did was different. She filled us with a feeling that we had to work to win, that we had to focus to learn, and whatever was happening anywhere outside of her class didn't matter. We had to get it right or be exposed and embarrassed. On our second day in our first grade class, as soon as we arrived, she handed out blank sheets of paper and gave us our second quiz. We couldn't believe it. We just looked around at each other. "Learning is not only repeating," she told us. "Learning includes remembering," she said, slowly pronouncing each word. "Everything you learn should be remembered and used in your life." When she collected our papers, she made every student stand. She called out our names and separated us into 2 groups. "These are the students who remembered," she pointed. "These are the students who forgot," she pointed. Immediately, she gave each student in the group who remembered a bag of multicolored marbles. Then she told the kids who forgot, "If you don't learn to read and write, you can't do anything." We stood there feeling ashamed. Shame was a new feeling for me. I was a rich girl from a rich family, the best family in my Brooklyn hood. I never had a reason to feel shame before I met Miss Jenk. I read that the way that she wrote it, okay? As we, the forgetters, had to remain standing, answering Miss Jenkins like we was in chorus, I got red and redder. Miss Jenkins called out, "If you don't learn to read and write, whose fault is it?" Then she taught us all to respond by saying it out loud. "If I don't learn to read or write, then it is my fault." At the end of class, I took my paper to Miss Jenkins. "I got a 95, I said to her. She looked down at me and said, "That's not 100. When I told Mama, she said, "Fuck her. Who does she think she is messing with my pretty baby?" Later that night, Mama gave me a card plastered with gold stars that she must have got from the 5 and dime. Now, I had 100 gold stars from mom, but somehow I still wanted that one gold star and that 100% from Miss Jenkins. By the end of first grade, I could read and write very well. I enjoyed reading and writing to impress Miss Jenkins, a teacher who spent so much time with that one day I accidentally called her mommy. Even though I admired Miss Jenkins, I didn't enjoy reading books on my own because the books were all boring. My real life was way better. As the best learners and rememberers were rewarded daily and immediately by Miss Jenkins, I learned the deeper meaning of what she meant when she told us, if you don't learn to read and write, you can't do anything. As those of us who learned to read and write well sat watching a Disney animation film on a huge, portable, white and silver screen, while Miss Jenkins' personal popcorn popper popped popcorn and her hot plate melted the butter, the forgetting, slow learning kids sat in a corner rewriting their mistakes 100 times. There was no movie, no popcorn, no butter, no fun or relief for them. They couldn't even see the screen. They couldn't do nothing. Everybody knew who they were. I wasn't down with them. I hate feeling ashamed. Open it up to page 100, the pretty Puerto Rican said, standing close, right in front of my desk. I'm not listening to you, I told her. You wasted 18 minutes already, she said. So what? I answered, all blasé. I'm Lena, number two, the Diamond Needles. You better start showing me some respect, little girl. Riot left this for you. Read it, she said, then walked away, strutting. I opened the book, thinking, oh, so now she knows I know how to read, huh? Slipped between page 100 and 101 was a folded news article. I opened it up, flipped it around, and smoothed it out with both hands. It was my papa. My whole little face got hot. My fingers suddenly felt moist. I rubbed my palms together, and my tears fell into my hands. Nervously, I looked up to check who was looking. Lena was looking. Her stern stare softened some as she saw my tears. I was angry at myself for crying. Swiftly, I looked away, then down. The photo of Papa had pull like a thousand magnets. I stared at it, wished I could fall or leap into the frame and talk to him as he hugged me warmly, like he used to hug women. His face looked serious and tight. It was strange to see him there without Mama right beside him. How could they leave her out? The two of them were always the perfect picture. There is no king without a queen, Papa would say. Maybe that's why in the photo he wasn't smiling or calm like he usually was. No queen, no winter, no Mercedes, no Lexus, no me. Come to think of it, his feeling in the photo and my feelings right then were exactly the same. I shifted my eyes away from the news clip. I pictured Papa in my mind. One day he wore a black tailored suit with genuine alligator shoes. Him in his suit, dress shirt, gaiters, and cufflinks were so handsome, he made Mama pause and go silent. She already was dressed up fly, but after she saw Papa, she went back to her bedroom. Her door closed. Moments later, it opened slowly. She came out looking like a million bucks, Papa said. I liked the pictures in my head better than the ones in the newspaper, although no flick of Papa could up or lessen his permanently handsome face. I read New York Daily News, Bedtime in Bedford-Stuyvesant by Edith Cates, Brooklyn, New York, February 6, 1996. Ever since the January 1994 arrest of gangster Ricardo Santiaga and the takedown of his reputed narcotics machine, there has been peace in the notorious Bed-Stuy section of Brooklyn. In a sweep that ran through the rough streets of the Stuy, its crack vial strewn alleyways and abandoned buildings, over rooftops and stretched to the manicured lawns and mansions of Dix Hills, Long Island, 28 members of Santiago's team were captured, cuffed, arrested, and arraigned. Charges ran from misdemeanors to murders. Crime boss Ricardo Santiago, known for his enviable management skills and ability to command complete loyalty from his crime partners, was captured in a pre-dawn police raid of his Long Island estate. Santiago, who strangely had no priors despite his 10-year rise to power over a $100 million crack empire, managed to rack up a rap sheet overnight that ranged from felony weapons possession to manslaughter to tax evasion, and eventually to include premeditated murder. Fast forward 2 years after Santiaga's arrest, Bed-Stuy has experienced a 50% decrease in its murder rate and an 85% decrease in drug-related arrests. Local residents, who once were completely silent when questioned by police regarding Santiaga, now appear happy to let their children out of their apartments and into the new park provided by Mayor Rudolph Giuliani, who is building a safer New York for all law-abiding citizens, replete with a visible increase in neighborhood police presence. Now we can breathe, one Bed-Stuy resident who asked to remain anonymous said. I bet they did ask to remain anonymous. He would not have been so outspoken if Ricardo Santiago were not behind bars, serving natural life. Give me 1 second, you guys. My headset just cut off on me. I'm sorry. Supposed to last 4 hours, child. But I was leaving them off of the thing for a little bit, trying to let them get used to not being on all the time so that the charge might last a little longer. So forgive me, guys. Okay. Now we back in business. Okay. Now let me wet my whistle right quick since we're on a quick pause. All right. The reporter's words were funky. I sat still for some minutes, maybe more. Then her words and all images flew out of my mind, and there was just a blank black space. Feelings I had murdered months ago began flooding back. No, began flooding the black space in my head and then my heart. My new tears felt like boiling water. The rims of my eyes were hot. I bet the bitch who wrote the article didn't know that my father read the New York Daily News every day. Papa would have looked down on that reporter for looking down on her customers. Nobody treated their customers better than Papa. Mama and us even got into trouble with him sometimes if we acted up around our Brooklyn hood. Finally, I took a deep, deep breath, looked up, and Lena's arm was stretched out before me, her hand holding two tissues. Lena, let me get a sheet of paper. Oh, and an envelope. You got one? I asked. Instead of answering me right back, she used the tissues to wipe away my tears. She held my chin lightly and began wiping my whole face. I felt something. Then Lena's face changed to thought. I believe that I understood exactly what she was thinking. In lockdown, it's difficult to get our hands on anything. It ain't easy like how it was when we was back in our homes. To get even the smallest items required us to have money on the books at commissary, something of equal value to trade, or some kind of long request process, paperwork, and explanation to some counselor authority. To get things quickly, like we needed and wanted, we'd have to plot, steal, or beat someone's ass for it. I don't steal. I'd rather convince. Lena took back the book with the article stuffed inside on page 100. She returned with the Newsweek magazine. She laid it on my desk without explanation and walked away over where the librarian was and began talking with her quietly. I listened, but didn't turn my head around. I was flipping the magazine pages, hoping Lena had placed the news article back inside. I found it, along with two sheets of paper and one envelope. I addressed the envelope to Edith Cates, the New York Daily News, New York, New York, with no street address and no zip code, because I didn't know it. I figured the mailman had to know it already. He probably had to drag them sacks of mail every day. On the first sheet of paper, I wrote using the pencil that was chained to my desktop and all of the desktops in here. It was on a chain so short I could barely angle it enough to write. I wrote, "Dear Miss Cates, I call you Miss because you're probably not married and have no family at all. You probably are a very lonely person who thinks you know everything, but you don't know nothing at all. I don't know how you got that job at the Daily News because you are a liar. No one should let a liar write for a newspaper because people depend on you to tell the truth, especially people who have no other way of finding out if their mother or father or sisters are even dead or alive, or whether or not they are somewhere living their lives with smiles on their faces, or even if they were killed in an accident. My father, Ricky Santiaga, is a good man, a hard worker, and great friend. Every place he went, there was nothing but smiles. In Brooklyn, In the summertime, when the ice cream truck rolled around, he would pull out a $100 bill and give it to Joe, the ice cream man, so every kid outside on the block could eat. Everybody's mother thanked my father for the good things he did all the time. My father gave the best block party every year. People who didn't even live on our block came around. One time, there must have been more than 1,000 people. That party was the first time I ever danced on stage for an audience. I was 6 years old. You should have heard the people cheer. A few of them even threw money. I don't get it. How y'all could try and make a good family look bad? You steal their children, put them in a place that might look good, but is bad. I don't know exactly where my papa is. From what you wrote, I guess y'all got him in a cage. He can't get out, so y'all comfortable lying on him. Why do you all love to put people in cages? I can tell he's looking for me. Even in your dull black and white paper, his eyes shine, and I could feel his nose and mouth breathing. That's the only thing I can thank you for. After 739 days, I can say for sure, Papa's alive. If you found my father, Ricky Santiaga, would you even tell me? You should try and meet him. Talk to him. I'll bet you'll fall in love right then and there. But you better not, because my mama will whoop your ass for definite. I be Princess Portia L. Santiaga, number 7261994, royalty. Mail it for me, I said to Lena as she walked up on me from behind and lifted the closed magazine from my desk. I knew she would check the clock, so I did too. There were 7 minutes left before the guard would appear to release me from the chair and move me to my next class. Mail it for me, please, Lena repeated, correcting me softly. I owe you one, I told her. Paper, envelope, stamp, delivery, and my time, she said, quietly pulling down each of her pretty fingers as she counted out my debt. What do you want from me? I asked her. Meet me here at the library every day for the next 7 days during rec. For what? I asked her. You'll say it's for math tutoring. Between you and me, though, you're gonna have to get your shit together if you want to get up with us Diamond Eagles. Riot saw something in you, but for me, I won't let you get away with no little kid tricks. You want to walk and move with the big girls? You grown? You better act like it, Mama Sita. She strutted away. I watched her. I was thinking she probably would have told me to come hit her library every day for a week, even if I didn't ask to borrow the paper and envelope. The guard came through. I had my eyes on Lena as he uncuffed my ankles. Get up, the guard said. I stood. It all made sense to me. Lena, number two, I thought to myself. The name of our crew is the Diamond Needles. That rocks, I thought to myself. Sounds beautiful. I pictured Lena standing beside Riot. She made Riot look more good. Girls love to have pretty friends. That way, one day we could all walk down the street together, knowing that there was no reason for any of us to feel jealous, because we was all doing it with our original styles, flair, and finesse. Each girl in our group having plenty of options. I would have picked Lena too, definitely. I didn't know if Lena would really mail the letter for me. I figured out not to trust even one mouth moving. It didn't matter, I told myself. Showing up at the library instead of rec was nothing to me. While I was wearing the red jumper, I couldn't do shit at rec anyway, just be cuffed and stuck. Late that same night, I laid close to Siri thinking about Riot. Riot must be smart, I thought. Yeah, she told me her story, but it seemed she had already known my story. Maybe she chose me because she read the words $100 million empire in the news article. Or maybe she knew other things that were written in the newspapers about my family and maybe even about me. But I knew for sure that nothing in a newspaper could be trusted. Unless you are a part of someone's life every day or even just with them most of the time, you will never really know what they have and had, what happened with them, and how they really are, what they do, why they do it that way, and what they feel. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay, all right, let me see what y'all are saying. I done missed people commenting, but hey, I'm reading. All right, so hey, sweet pea, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Said I'm here just waking up from a nap. I fell asleep during your last video, girl. Your voice is so soothing. Oh man, I'm gonna have to gruff it up and fuck it up a little bit so y'all won't So it'll grate on y'all nerves like nails on a chalkboard, and then y'all won't be falling asleep. Child, people been falling asleep to my voice for the longest time. So I can't help it. Like, shit, maybe I really am boring, huh? Anyway, whatever. So let me see what else happened here. So Bikini is talking about the book. All right, Sweet Pea said, "Hey, Moz and chat, everyone here. Happy early mommy day. Same to you, Sweet Pea." All right, so Cindy said, "Yes." Sweet Pea reminding you guys to like, share, and subscribe. Mother was laughing. Sweet Pea said, "I remember those pencil cases." Yes. Okay, so Wings and Mumble Sauce said, "I like Miss Jenkins." Yes, I like Miss Jenkins too. Okay, Miss Jenkins is that buttery hotness. She gonna make your little ass learn to read, right? I'm gonna learn to read, right? Either that, or you gonna be thought of as a dumbass, or as they say, those who forgot, right? Yes, Pops done got popped. He got popped. Okay, thank you, Sweet Pea, for sharing the video. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. Hey, Mimi, welcome. Say, hey, Saki Mods and chat. I'm excited about this one. I will have to go back later. All right, hey, Mimi. Okay, well, thank you for being here. We appreciate you. So, Mother said, yes, Portia, yes. She was pissed off about that doggone newspaper article. It is getting good. Right, Wings? I'm gonna just call you Wings instead of saying Wings and Mambo Sauce, child. That's a lot. Plus, it's kind of making me hungry. I should probably just call you Sauce. No, either way, anything in that in your screen name is gonna make me hungry, right? So I'm gonna just call you Wings. All right, Wings. So Black Diamond said, just listen to the word fuck. My God, Mother, I'm sorry. I don't know why, but I do. I pronounce it like that. Okay, so we are getting ready to start the next chapter. We'll start it at 1 hour and 46 minutes. That's what it says. So listen, child. I love me some wings. You heard me? I'm kind of mad that I didn't think about that for dinner, but that's okay. Y'all, give me a second. Let me drink some water. Right. Chapter 6. Hables, Lena asked me when I showed up for my math tutoring. Huh? I answered back. Tú eres Santiago, sí? No hables, she said. What? I said. Then she understood to speak fucking English. I ain't Spanish, I told her. I'm not Spanish either, Lena said. Her face was relaxed. Her body was still, but her eyes were revealing her fierceness. Yo soy un boricua puertorricano. Don't forget it, she said to me. But how could I remember something I didn't understand in the first place? I can see why these young chicks want to punch you in your face, Lena said. You come off all wrong, she spoke calmly, but I could tell she was working hard to hold back her temper. Maybe you won't be happy till you got a $1.50 on your face. I know one girl up here who didn't know how to shut her mouth, so someone sliced her face open with a razor. What would you do if that happened to you? I'd cut her back, I said. As long as the one who sliced my face was walking around with her face sliced open too, I would wear my scar. I couldn't complain, I said honestly, then shrugged my shoulders like I do when I don't have nothing else to say. You stupid, stupid little girl, she said it softly, but it was heartfelt. I didn't let Lena see that she hurted my feelings. Yes, she said hurted. But she did. I hated to be put down. I hated for anyone to play me like I'm dumb. I hated that I could tell that she rarely believed that I was stupid. I hated, I didn't say rarely. No, I hated that I could tell that she really believed that I was stupid. I hated that I liked Lena a lot and she either couldn't tell or didn't care. I hated that now Lena thought I was fighting because I was a stuck-up little stupid bitch and not because I was defending myself. I'm 10. Lena is either 15 or 16. She is in the beige tan jail jumper. Why was she coming so hard for me? Tears bubbled up, then streamed down my face. She got up and came back with a tissue. It was the second time on our second day of meeting that she wiped my tears for me while I was red, my wrist controlled on a short chain, ankles cuffed to the chair. After she did that, I was feeling hate and love towards her, and I was confused. Don't you know that when you are pretty, everybody expects you to be stupid? Lena asked me. She was seated back close to me, pretending to be tutoring me in math. Her question repeated in my mind, don't you know that when you're pretty, everyone expects you to be stupid? I sat thinking, Lena is saying that she thinks I'm pretty. That mixed my feelings up for her even more. A girl should never be stupid unless she is pretending to be stupid to save her own life, Lena said. I'm not stupid, I said confidently. How does a stupid person know that she's stupid? Lena asked me. I didn't answer. Exactly, Lena said, as if I had actually answered her question. Exactly what? I asked. If you are stupid, you would be too stupid to know it, she said, without smiling or laughing. I still didn't say nothing. When you meet someone who is on your side, start off by introducing yourself. That's what smart people do, Lena said. That's not really smart. If I am just meeting someone, how would I know if they are on my side or not? How would I tell them my name? I asked, and I meant it. I was looking at Lena, waiting for her to answer. I meant, Lena started to say, whatever, I introduced myself to you. I told you I was Lena, number two, the Diamond Needles. You knew then that I was on your side. Okay, I'm Porsche El Santiago. I'm 10. I like music. I like to dance. I don't like to fight. I don't start fights with anyone, but I will fight anybody who starts a fight with me, even if I don't think I can win. I'm pretty. Lena, you're pretty too. So you know how it is. These ugly bitches got us surrounded. We both laughed. I exhaled a lot and then felt easier with Butterscotch Lena, who I had thought had no smile. I like your haircut, I said to Lena suddenly. Did you cut it yourself? I asked. No, we have a salon in Building A. My girl Ginger cut it. She's Diamond Needle number nine, Lena said. She has a jail job? I asked, all surprised. All Diamond Needles gotta hustle. The hair hustle is the biggest payday. But Chica, I get mines done for free. Me and Ginger in the same clique, so we take care of each other. Lena put her fingers in her hair, stroking through the soft black half curls, stopping at her neck where it was still silky but cut low and clean. And these aren't jail jobs. You young, but don't forget, we're in prison, not jail. We're convicted, not on trial. We're on lockdown, viewed as violent and a threat to society. I knew all of that, but it sounded even worser when Lena said it all out loud. To make it in here, you gotta start off by choosing the right family, the family with the right connection, she said. Like how Riot chose you, I asked her. That's not how it happened, she said, still calm and cool, but it's true. With our clique, girls have to be chosen by either me or Riot. It's the only way to get up with us. Ginger number nine can't choose nobody. And numbers 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, after they in the Diamond Needles, they can't bring nobody in who they choose. No, Nunca, Lena said. Nunca, I repeated. Never, Lena translated. I sat thinking for some seconds. I knew now that Lena didn't choose me. I wondered if that meant she didn't approve. Maybe she disagreed with Riot's choice. What if Riot wants someone in and you don't? Confianza, Lena said. Between me and Riot, there is trust. We don't argue. We trust each other's choices. We know that if either of us chooses the wrong person, both of us will suffer, then fail. Riot and me always say, if you tell on me, you tell on yourself. So we don't worry. Everyone we deal with has something to lose, something to gain, and something to protect. Riot wouldn't have chosen you if you didn't have something to lose, something to gain, and something to protect. Lena's lesson went on like that. It was more heavy than being in math, science, or English class. I found myself doing way more thinking. Lena placed her words carefully. It seemed like every other sentence from her was laced with a threat and a challenge. Lena told me there are 528 inmates locked down here as of today. In 1 second, that number could increase or decrease. There are 29 gangs in here. In 28 of the crews, you gotta get jumped in to get down with them. That means you gotta get your ass beat by the whole crew. Maybe they'll fuck up your face or shove a broom in your little pussy or tight asshole. Like that ain't enough. You could get ordered to do something dumb, hurt yourself, or someone else you don't got no beef with. Then your time here on lockdown doubles or triples up, Lena said, like she was disgusted. She was leaning forward in her chair, one hand pressing down on her leg and the other on her hip. All that shit is retarded. We don't get down like that. We're pretty and we're smart. We make moves that the dumb ones can't figure out. We money girls, she said, and she was definitely speaking my language now. What if one of them 28 other gangs decide they don't like the Diamond Needles girls? What if one Diamond Needle girl gets jumped? Do the rest of our clique supposed to let that slide just because we're supposed to be smarter and prettier than everybody else who's locked up in here, same as us? I asked. No, we pay any bitch back, but not the way they expect. We run this prison. The diamond needles are in all the right places. Everything runs through us or by us. Every diamond needle girl is in a power position. Since we got the power and we make the money, we get the respect. If anyone crosses us, we don't beat them with our fists. Why should we fuck ourselves up? We outsmart them. We squeeze them. Squeeze them, I repeated. Squeeze them, she repeated. Every day with Lena brought a new lesson, a new assignment, and a new understanding. I ain't slow, so I caught on and caught up. There were 7 days of lessons. Lesson one was trust, followed by silence, loyalty, friendship, teamwork, style, and method. On the last day of my 7 lessons, Lena said to me, "Being la bambina más joven, the youngest of the Diamond Needles clique, is a double-edged sword. The older girls will feel even more protective over you. They might try and spoil you. Some might even expect less from you. On the other hand, since you are the youngest, you have to show all your big sisters the most respect. Answer to all the members, and you'll follow the most amount of instructions." Lena also told me not to milk the baby thing. If I wanted to be equal, I should work hard and earn my status. I noticed Lena called the other diamonds her sisters, while Riot called me and Siri her sons. I didn't think on it too long. Family is family. Even though the 7th lesson day completed my training, I wanted to stay close with Lena. I liked her. She was smart and pretty, serious, but still fun. She was warm if you got to know her, and cold if you didn't. For me, style and method were the hardest lessons of all. For style, I had to use manners I wasn't used to using. I had to introduce myself to each of the diamond needles separately. I had to remember their names and numbers. I had to learn their likes, dislikes, and requests, and be on call to help anyone on our team at any time that I could. I had to give each diamond needle a tribute or gift. The gift giving wasn't so bad. I understood that in here, you couldn't get something for nothing. Plus, I still had my candy hustle going. I dreamed up an idea that I would put in motion immediately. I'd make some little packets of arts and crafts. Siri would decorate them. I'd put in assorted candies, and that would be my gift. For people on the outside, that might not sound like shit. But in here, a little sugar was hard to obtain and could take me far. For method, Lena explained, you have to be disciplined enough to follow a plan of action. You have to think with all of your girls in mind, and not only yourself. You have to respond to all communications as quickly as possible. You have to make sure you don't mess up or interrupt what the DN is trying to achieve. What are we doing first? I asked her. It's your first thing, but to us, it's just one more thing we're doing, in the middle of doing everything else, she said. I seen that Lena liked to remind me that I was the young one. We were the last ones to be chosen, Siri and me. It seemed like she thought that I was the most likely to fuck up. Out of loyalty to Riot and respecting the DN code of silence, I wasn't telling Lena that I chose Siri to be in the Diamond Needles and that Riot approved it. Lena believed that only she and Riot could choose members, but having Siri in the gang was a condition of my hooking up with them. So, what am I doing first? I corrected myself for Lena. You're not going to fight with anyone else, she said with the most mean look on her serious face since me and her first met. You are going to let us handle the cha-cha beef. You are going to make it to the Festival de la Familia, she said, speaking Spanish again. Then she said in English, the annual family festival, which no prisoner can attend if they have even one violent episode 90 days prior to the festival date, which is on Saturday, July 20th, 1996. Okay, but I started saying, you've been locked down here for almost 3 years. You missed 2 festivals because of fighting. The third one is coming up in 4.5 months, she said. Cha-Cha is fucking crazy. You think I can schedule my fights with her? Whenever she flips out and fucks with me, so I fight her. Are you smarter than her, or is she smarter than you? Lena asked me. You already know, I said swiftly, or Raya would have chosen Cha-Cha for the diamond needles instead of me, I said confidently. Good. Then do as I say. Stop allowing her to deal you the same hand every time. Cha-Cha is controlling you. If she keeps you fighting, she keeps you from having any privileges, Lena said. She loses her privileges too, I answered back swiftly. So what? She's nobody. She's ignorant. She don't make real moves. She doesn't make money. She don't have no organized team. She don't do nothing but keep the trouble brewing, Lena said. her temper showing only through her pretty eyes. Portia, you have to make everyone believe that you have changed by changing your method of reacting and doing things. Even if you haven't really changed on the inside, like your feelings and stuff, you have to make them believe that you have, Lena said. And I felt at that moment that that was what she had done. On the inside, she was angry and boiling, like me. For some reason, she saw or learned a benefit to convincing others that she wasn't. Santiago, Lena said, calling me by my last name. I liked the way it sounded coming from her lips, so different than from the wardens. Make customers, not war, Lena said, sounding like my papa. The festival is the only time of year where, for 4 hours and 15 minutes, we can roam freely on the yard and mix with other people who aren't locked down like us. Some of us get only one day a year for a family member to travel all the way up here to visit us. Or it's our only chance to see somebody we really like, not through a glass or dirty bulletproof plastic or over a bullshit phone or through a fence or gate, not sitting in a small room without the chance to even touch or hug. Some girls got business on the yard on festival day. There are always competitions and prizes, good shit that can be won and sold. We diamond needles are all about our business and opportunities. Once a year, the festival is an opportunity for us to each do something different. Earn something extra, and see somebody special. You too, Santiago. Lena had me open. It was not because of no fucking festival, though. I just liked her and the feeling coming from her and the way she made me feel like she believed in something. More than that, she made me feel like even though she doubted me, she loved me. Of course she loved me. She sat and spoke to me and listened to me when I spoke. She taught me things I needed to know and gave me things she didn't have to give. When she got mad at something I said, she didn't give up or abandon me. She took the time to explain herself and her meaning. Even though I knew Lena wouldn't say so, she knew I was smart enough, even though I was young. She wouldn't have wasted her time if she wasn't sure I was capable. The last question I asked her before parting, you say all the diamond needles have a hustle. What's yours, Lena? Data, she said. I thought she was speaking in Spanish again. Data is information. It's the most important hustle, not only in here, but in total el mundo, the whole world. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, so let me see what y'all are saying. All right, y'all laughing at me because I said his name was making me hungry. Okay, let me see. Okay, let me get some coffee in my system for a second. And then we'll get to the Chapter 7. Two months later, I'm on the yard. Been in a baby blue jumper with no red interruptions, no fights, no lockdown at the bottom. Authorities are shocked at my turnaround. Instead of them leaving me alone for not fighting no more, they look me over more closer. They wouldn't get nothing new on me. I'm determined. Getting ganged up was the best thing that happened to me since I was separated from my real family. Don't get me wrong. Prison is prison. Not fun or a fucking picnic, but being connected eased some of my stresses. I wasn't silly enough to think my piece of peace would go on for the whole stretch of my stay, but even a brief break from the pressure was welcomed. It felt good to know I was not affiliated with just any group, but with the sharpest girls on the yard. Unlike at my real home, which would always be the only real place for me, here, I wasn't the invisible middle child. I was the baby, and I had 10 big sisters. True, I wasn't old enough to catch a prison job, internship, or assignment. Still, I made my own hustle using what I already had to get what I wanted and to play my part in the clique. I didn't want to stay the baby or the son forever. I wanted to even up. So, in the C dorm where I had influence, I listened and learned. I sorted through and counted up the opportunities available for festival day. I had done my research and found out that there was a talent competition for us quizzes. The prize was a gift basket that had all the shit every girl in here needed every day, but most couldn't afford to get or ran out of too quick. Plus, it had some stuff we never even dreamed of getting our hands on until we hit time serve and walked out of this miserable joint. The prize basket contained the latest technology that many of us never seen or heard of. We were used to cassette tapes and cassette players. While we were locked up, it switched. So the fact that the prize basket contained a CD player along with a DVD player, CDs and DVDs donated by entertainment companies made it 10 times more valuable. The basket also had three phone cards, which added up to 180 minutes or 3 hours of phone talk and stuff like lotions, soaps, deodorants, perfume, and hair products, as well as a stationery set with stamps and some books and magazines that were supposed to be the good ones. I knew for sure that whoever won that first place basket could open up a business in here and work each item in trade or sale or use for about a year, no doubt. I even considered that the DVDs and CDs didn't even have to be sold. If they were mine, I would open up my own version of Blockbuster and rent out the DVDs and CDs so they kept making money for me year round. Even the books and magazines would hold weight, especially if they chose the right ones that girls from the hood would sweat and probably weren't available in the library. The shit that wasn't being discussed was that whoever won that basket would need an army to keep it. Even if they won it fair and square, the first place winner would turn into a target in seconds, no doubt. Riot wasn't in agreement about the prize basket or the competition. She said the authorities were slick and the robots were dumb. Watch how they kill each other to get their hands on that first prize. Robots said that the authorities paid for all that shit in the basket with money they made off of us. She also told me that the authorities would use the basket to keep the inmates in check and use the talent show to show the state what a good job they had done in controlling us and how happy we all were to be in prison. So happy that we are up here singing and dancing for our captors. That's what you're gonna do, right, Portia? Dance for the authorities at the festival? Riot asked me. No, I answered back swiftly. I'm the producer and choreographer for the seven girls that are gonna grab first place. I'm gonna teach them the dopest moves. When they win, they're gonna pay me my fee. Pretty smart, Riot said. How much you pulling? One DVD player and whatever DVDs come with it. I open my own movie house. Only the diamonds will get in for free, I said. We both laughed a little. Riot hugged my shoulders. I was working my way up to being even. Aside from the reason I gave Riot about why I couldn't be dancing in the show, there was the fact that Mama said, one day, someone will pay you $1 million to move your hips like that. Before Riot ever brought it up, I had already decided not to dance with the seven girls who I selected after auditioning them. Prize basket or not, nobody in this fucking place could afford my dance performance. It was windy on the yard, but we managed to get up a game of double dutch. For us, it wasn't an average after-school type game. After all, there was a rope involved. That meant there was a guard posted nearby, close enough to us for her to be one of the players. But she wasn't playing. Now, I don't know if it's all right for a woman to weigh 300 pounds, but this guard was pushing it, and it was not the kind of fat that folded over, then dropped or hanged. Hers was packed on her body like how frozen freezing ice cream is packed in the barrel in the ice case in the corner store. It was fat pretending to be muscle. Funny thing is, we knew for a fact that she could run like a lightweight. A bunch of us witnessed her dashing across the yard to break up a brawl, her heavy hands pulling bodies apart, then tossing them. Young ones got hurt more than they would have without her help. Her grip only choked and crushed, so we requested the rope, playing nice with it, and would return it to her 5 minutes before it was time to leave the yard. 1, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 2, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. We counted it out, all nine of us singing together. There were seven gutter girls and two diamond needles, Riot and Tiny. Or should I say, there were seven gutter girls and three diamond needles, since I was in both gangs, the one I started and the one I joined on the low. It was my turn, and I was killing it. Turn faster, I called out as I danced between the two ropes, lifting my feet like lightning. I started crisscrossing them and then paused, amazing myself by picking the beat back up in time to avoid losing a second of rhythm or tripping. I was gonna keep the gutter girl gales, who they used to call greedy gale, arms turning two ropes until they were slim and sore. Siri showed up and went wild cheering for me. Both crews had to give it up to me when I bent down between the ropes and jumped out the next set from the squatting position. I'm supposed to be able to do it like that. I'm a dancer, and rhythm and movement is my expertise. I leaped up from my squatting, returned to skipping, then suddenly switched to the one-foot hop. As I spun while hopping, I caught a glimpse of Cha-Cha on the yard, mean mugging me. I kept hopping and didn't miss a beat. Riot had told me many weeks ago that Cha-Cha has been neutralized. When I asked Riot what that meant, she said, it means she won't fuck with you no more. To me, that meant that Cha-Cha didn't want to fight no more because it wasn't like she was some powerful bully and I was her scared victim who she beat up. Most of the time, I got the best of Cha-Cha in our past brawls, which is most likely why the bitch kept sweating me for a rematch. I once twisted her right arm so hard I thought I broke it, but it was only sprained. I had punched out one of her teeth and lifted a patch of hair from her scalp. Honestly, she got two good shots off on me. She kicked me hard in my ribs and pulled one of my fingers trying to pop my bone out. I got loose from her grip quick enough before she could do any permanent damage. Still, my finger got hurt and throbbed and swelled a couple of days before it went back to the same way it was before. It had been 2 months of Cha-Cha acting like I was dead. When she saw me, she wouldn't even lift her eyes or move the muscles on her face. Now she was sending off a fighting stare. My mind started shifting. My eyes were focusing on her ugly face. It made me miss a beat, and finally, I was out. Damn, I thought you would never give up, Gail said, her arms collapsing and her side of the rope going limp. A gutter girl named Brianna sucked her teeth before asking me, what the fuck was you thinking? You were like a possessed witch inside the ropes. Everyone laughed. I didn't get red about it. She was my girl. I knew she didn't mean me no ill will. Besides, I had taught her to read and write. That's how I hooked her for the gutter girls. She was steady drawing pictures and mailing them out. They weren't even beautiful pictures, just some crayon type shit. Siri said to me, she can't write. Instead of embarrassing Brianna, I went by her bed and said, let's put some words on your drawings, like a storybook. I have good handwriting. Tell me what you want to say. I'll write it down neatly. We got tight like that. Get your hands up, tiny number 10 of the diamond needle said. She was 13 and rocking the same yellow jumper as Riot. But still, she was our same small size, like she could fit in with the baby blues. She was so petite, other than her two grapefruit-sized titties. She was next up to the rope and wanted her turn. As Tiny pushed off and jumped in, Riot pulled me back some. The real bitches are trying to recruit Cha-Cha. No matter how she glares at you, don't make a move. Got it? Riot was talking to me without looking at me. She was surveying the movements on the yard. And that's the end of that chapter. All right. So, chapter 8. Okay, we counted everything, and everything counted. We counted seconds, minutes, hours, days, weeks, months, and years. We counted asses in the shower and how many heads were in the gym. We counted off during head counts. We counted visits and visitors and the amount of days without visits or visitors. We counted days until hearing dates, court dates, and of course, release dates. We counted the number of letters received or not received, days between connected phone calls, rejected phone calls, or no phone calls at all. We counted days since our mothers came or never came. We counted squares in the floor, lights in the ceiling, colors of uniforms. We counted the number of guards, staff, and workers. We even counted the teeth in our teacher's mouth as they talked. We counted everything, and everything counted. We counted them. They counted us. We counted. They counted. There was a fork missing from the count in the kitchen and one butcher knife. The alarms went off in the building. Guards charged through the halls, some ragged in riot gear. All inmates moving to the final activities of the day and all inmates doing anything anywhere were paused as a trained reaction to the alarm. Special guards swept us up in a single file line. The girls in the same hall area where I was standing were all escorted into the gym. No talking, they commanded us. Spread out, both hands up. One guard demonstrated. We didn't need any demonstration. This is how we always measured space between girls on the gym floor. I didn't tell you to put them down, she barked. I knew that now she would make us hold that position for ridiculously long. In here, all adults, staff, teachers, and whatever guards were delighted by little acts of torture. There were girls of mixed ages in the gym lineup. I knew after counting 15 rows of 10 girls that they also had a lineup on the yard, maybe the slop house and in the dorm hallway in one of the larger buildings. Put them down, the guard ordered. Me and Riot's eyes met. We were both scanning the rows, counting diamond needles. I seen number 7, Hamisha. She couldn't be missed. She was an Indian with a long Indian braid tucked inside her tan jumper, the color worn by 15 and 16-year-olds. I didn't know her name before I got ganged up, but I had seen her way before then at the hospital, which these people in here call the infirmary. She had the pretty face and the dirtiest job, emptying pots after inmate patients peed, vomited, or crapped. She got to wear gloves and sometimes a paper face mask. When she wasn't collecting the shit that no one wanted to touch, she was mopping floors and wiping down counters with some stinky smelling stuff. She had walked past my hospital bed where I was lying and locked from time to time. She only spoke to me once, saying, "You are the only one who misses your mom more than I miss Mary Mom." "Mary Mom?" I repeated with my dried out lips. "My mother," she translated. "How would you know that I miss my mama more?" I asked curiously. "Besides, me and Siri were both bored." "I say you miss your ma more than I miss my Mary ma because I am still holding my missing her inside. You, on the other hand, cannot stop screaming it out." I realized Hamisha had heard me screaming the night before when I was giving the nurses hell. But hell was my true feeling and all I had to give at that moment. The female guards and many female staff poured into the gym. Row by row, we were body searched, fingers moving through our hair, hands moving around our necks, shoulders, arms, armpits, fingers, chests, breasts, stomachs, asses, private parts, thighs, knees, calves, ankles, toes. As each row was completed, the lead searchers called out, "All clear." When all 150 of us were confirmed all clear, the gym door clicked open and the warden walked in, backed up by four more guards. She dismissed the special guards. She must have felt more safe after the gymnasium body search turned up nothing. Warden Strickland was a black woman. Her feeling was the opposite of mama. I mean, she was in good body shape and normally wore either pants suits or skirt suits, but she seemed like a woman who had never been touched by a man, hugged by a small child, or loved by a mother and father. Her skin seemed hard, her eyes empty. Even her hair was stuck in one inflexible position, as though she sprayed it with holding hairspray every morning and never once rinsed out or washed the chemical out. Her strut seemed overdone, like she had to move that way to prove she was the warden. But all of us already knew that. "Ladies, there's one fork and one butcher knife missing from the kitchen supply cabinet. If you make it hard on me, I'll make it unbearable for you. Nobody will leave this facility and no one will be allowed in until the fork and knife are found. That means my staff, who already have worked a full shift, your teachers, the officers, no one can go home until the weapons are recovered. You're punishing them. You're punishing me. Now I'm punishing you. If I don't get the fork and knife back immediately, I will cancel the upcoming annual family festival. Why? Because if you don't help me, I won't help you." A gasp ran through the gym and echoed off of the high walls. A whistle blew. "You have 10 minutes. Keep your hands to yourselves. Talk to each other. Then send the one who is trying to separate you from your fun and families on family festival day up front, where I'm standing. The guilty one will definitely be disciplined, but you will not pay for her poor, violent, and selfish decision." The prisoner's talk started out as a murmur and rose to a roar. I thought to myself, the warden is sneakier than any one of us inmates. The lineup was broke up now as everyone took the 10 minutes granted by the warden as a break. Riot strolled over. Lay back, it's not us, she said. Hamisha broke her line and followed Riot. She was way calmer than everyone else. She looked in me and Riot's eyes and then stood beside us but didn't say nothing. Tiny popped up out of nowhere. I know you didn't see me, right? She asked all of us. I was standing between those two tall girls in the yellow. She used her head to point them out. So, what do you all think? Tiny asked. She won't cancel us. Oh no, she won't cancel. She wants us to believe that she will. The festival is for her. Not for us. Watch, the stupid robots will believe the warden. In a few minutes, they'll all cave in and start snitching on one another. But they searched us all already, I said. Yeah. And while they were searching us in here and the rest of us on the yard, you better know they were searching our beds, cells, and belongings, Riot said, and we four fell silent. Brawl broke out. Instead of everybody rushing forward to where the fists were swinging, everyone except the fighters fell back, leaving a huge space in the left corner that exposed three inmates. Guards raced in and attempted to yank them apart. When Warden ordered the guards to halt, the girls scuffling on the floor suddenly peeled themselves off of the other. They must have been shooken by the silence that surrounded them. Normally, the inmates would have been mobbing up and cheering or choosing sides and jumping in during a breakout brawl. But the threat of the festival cancellation held everyone spellbound. No one wanted to be mistakenly included in anything that could be cited as wrong behavior. Besides, when the guards start grabbing on any one of us, if we didn't settle and surrender, it was the stick or the shock of the taser. We all knew that the first punishment for the brawlers would come from the warden. If the festival got canceled because of them, the second but worst punishment would come from within. The enraged girls on lockdown would hit like bullets being fired from all directions, on the yard or in the slop house or in the gym, places where we all gathered in groups, gangs, and cliques, where payback was a bitch, revenge was the truth and our unspoken law. The three brawling girls were on their asses in front of the ward, their jumpers crooked and one of them ripped open. Does this have anything to do with my missing utensils, or is it that you three just wanted to make sure I canceled the festival? They're going to the bottom, I said casually to Riot. Because they're stupid, Riot agreed. The warden said only the one who took the fork and knife would be punished, Tiny said. Did you believe her? Look how the warden caused them to fight, and watch what she does next, Riot said quietly. The whistle blew. We froze in place. Hands out, one guard commanded. We all spaced ourselves. No more talk, the guard barked. The warden took one step forward. Sit, the warden said, and we all sat down in perfectly spaced, neat rows. We were all silent, nothing moving but our eyes. I could hear their hearts beating furiously. I could feel it, too. My heart was racing for different reasons. Me and Riot, Tiny, and a whole group of us, all ages and different gangs and cliques, were all state property. We were the ones who nobody showed up for, in court, at medical offices, or interviews and hearings, and even worser, for visitations. Riot's and Tiny's parents were murdered. My parents and family were considered dead because they were all on no-show. My body began to tremble beneath my jumper. The thought of having been abandoned and forgotten was too violent. I perspired as I watched the warden. The idea that, according to them, she was my legal mother made me feel nauseous. Now I was sick and tense like the rest of them. Not because of the fucking family festival where no one from my family would show. Not because of our 4 hours and 15 minutes of freedom or the best meal we having for the whole year. It was something more deeper than that going wrong inside of me. Walkie-talkies blared at a high volume suddenly. The A dorm is all clear, a male voice reported in to the warden. Move officers to the B dorm, she ordered. We could tell her anger was mounting. She wasn't the only one. A whistle sounded. Get on all fours, the warden commanded. We all looked around with questions printed on our faces. There were 300 eyeballs moving. Do whatever she says, Briar whispered to me. In a split second, the gym was packed with girls on their hands and knees, including the three brawlers. You want to act like animals, the warden asked. Whatever you're going to do in life, do it well. Now crawl, she ordered. There was a long pause, and most girls began crawling on hands and knees. Riot shot me a look. She was already crawling. I saw the warden maneuvering between the rows of crawling females. I thought about Lena. She wasn't in the gym. Was she somewhere crawling on her hands and knees? She taught me to think for all of the diamond needles and not only of myself. I knew they all wanted to attend the festival for business, friends, or fun. I knew Lena wanted to go and that she planned on seeing someone special to her. I had the dancing girls who I was training and who I knew were going to win if they perfected my routine. But I could step away from all that shit easily. It didn't mean much to me. If I catch you and you are not crawling, you will get disciplined for not obeying my orders, the warden called out in a controlled and angry voice. If I could be sure that winter was coming to visit me, would I crawl for that? I asked myself. My eyes filled with tears. It didn't matter. I was facing the floor and no one could see my tears if I kept my head down. So I did. I began crawling. I was angry that I even considered that winter would show up for me. I had promised myself many months ago not to think or believe or hope for even one visitor. That way, I could separate myself from the heavy feeling of disappointment and depression. The temperature of my body began to increase. The flow of heat within me was moving strangely because of the way I was bent down and crawling on my knees. Now bark, the warden ordered. Everyone. The gym made the barking sounds double and triple as each girl barked differently from one another. All dogs. Stop, the warden called out swiftly, and crawling, barking bodies bumped like bumper cars. Now move, she ordered, and there was another long pause. I was confused as to whether she was saying for us to move. But one girl began making cow noises, and soon every girl was doing it. My face was still facing the floor, so I didn't move, the same way I didn't bark. How would she tell who was and who wasn't barking or mooing? Does it feel good to behave like animals? The warden called out. Would you prefer to live like them? No one answered because they were all still mooing. Quiet, her voice overpowered everyone's. The mooing stopped. How do your knees feel? Should ladies crawl on their knees and bark like dogs and moo like cows who can only eat and poop? She asked. No one answered. Thankfully, I thought to myself. Drop down flat on your belly, she commanded. We were all now lying flat, facing the floor. Are you all a bunch of snakes? Are you sneaky, slimy creatures? You want to ruin it for one another? Let me hear you snakes hiss. The hissing sounds of more than 100 girls itched the insides of my ears, and I felt like a rash was traveling through the inside of my body. The sound was loud and disturbing. I vomited. The stinky goop landed beneath my chin on the floor I was facing. I could hear a few girls farting and a few crying. Stop, the warden screamed out. Stand up, she ordered next. At the sound of my whistle, all of you walk towards the wall that you're facing. Press your faces against the wall. Make your nose press against those cement blocks, she said. This shit was getting stranger and stranger. I wiped my mouth with my jumper and stepped over my wet pile and walked towards the closest wall. None of us could see one another or anything else because we were all facing one of the four walls, our backs to the warden. Not a comfortable feeling. From the sound of her movement and voice, she was walking towards the center with the guards. Close your eyes, she ordered. I don't know if everyone did. I didn't. But I didn't turn my head left or right, not even slightly. I know better than to tell on myself. Now, ladies, I hope we have reached an understanding. You don't want to be animals. I don't want to treat you like animals. No one can see your faces now. I want the person who knows where the fork and knife are hidden to raise her right foot. No one else will know who it is, but I will know. You will not be punished for providing the right information. You will be treated properly and rewarded kindly for saving lives. You will be the one who proves that you are not an animal living by the laws of the jungle. You are human enough to care about the safety of all of your peers, she said, politicking. We stood facing the wall for a half hour, silently. I wondered if anyone had already raised their foot even a little to signal the warden. Maybe she had already identified one or two or three snitches, but was making us stay facing the wall so she could pretend that no one had snitched. Then she would call the snitches to her office in the middle of the night or early in the morning when no one would notice that they were missing. Her walkie-talkie flared. Dorm B, all clear, the male guard's voice bounced around the gym. Search Dorm C. It's the last place I would expect to discover the weapons, but check carefully. Over, the warden ordered. Bathroom, I heard a girl's voice say softly. No bathroom, the warden called back angrily. You want to live like animals, then do it well. I could tell she was more madder because the guards were searching everywhere but not finding nothing. I peed. I don't know if anyone else did, but I had to pee from way back when the alarms were setting off and all this bullshit first started. I didn't dare move a leg or foot or turn my face to see what kind of puddle or stream I had made. I didn't need her calling me to her office like I had a damn thing to say to her. Everyone turn around, the warden said suddenly. We all turned. All my tans, pinks, and yellows. Walk over here and line up, the warden said, pointing to the center of the gym where she was standing. You are the ones who are supposed to set the example for the baby blues. If these are the kinds of things that you do, what are you teaching the babies to do? She asked, and I knew the bitch was just crazy. We baby blues weren't her babies. We were never treated in any type of way that someone who has a baby would act. We weren't treated no more specialer, Sister Souljah, no more specialer than any girl wearing any color prison jumper. Strip, she ordered the girls, ages 11 through 16, the pinks, yellows, and tans. But they all just looked around at one another and didn't do it. Strip, she repeated, this is a matter of security. Who knows what you are hiding beneath your clothes? Now step out of your shoes and strip. I got heated because we all had already been searched thoroughly. She knew she wouldn't find nothing through a strip that she hadn't found already. And who could hide a fork and knife in their ass or between their thighs or below their tongues? A few girls stripped boldly, letting the warden know it wasn't nothing to them to be naked, long as they got to attend the festival. The others followed one by one, their cheap prison shoes beside their feet and the jumpers piled on top. Tiny, the smallest girl up there, did not strip. Now, she was the only one who did. Miss Parker, are you any better than the rest of these girls? The warden asked. The warden asked Tiny. That was Tiny's real name, Chanel Parker. No better, Tiny said softly, then do as they have done. Or are you hiding the weapons, she asked. Tiny didn't answer. I know your history, Miss Parker. You better step out of your jumper in the next 3 seconds or you will pay the price, the warden threatened. I felt sorry for Tiny. Riot was up there completely nude. Hamisha was nude and in tears. Riot wasn't telling Tiny to obey what the warden said like she did back when we were first ordered to crawl. Tiny pulled off her jumper slowly. As it dropped to the floor, she immediately tried to cover herself with her small hands. She could only conceal her nipples. She couldn't cover the truth. Her beige skin, her back and sides and stomach were all covered with dark brown marks of different shapes and sizes. There was a long scar that bubbled on her thigh just below her butt, and there were even some scars behind her knees. In the silence of every girl seeing Tiny's life story stamped and scraped and burned and sliced into her skin, obviously painfully, I wanted to murder the warden. I didn't want to shoot her with a gun, which would have been too gentle. I wanted to cut her with a knife and burn her with a few lighted cigarettes the way someone obviously did Tiny. I wanted to embarrass her, humiliate her. Torture her. I wanted her to feel what each of us had to be feeling. It was the emotion I hated the most of all emotions. Shame. Late night, I couldn't sleep. We were all returned to our right spaces after the weapons were discovered in the C dorm where I was housed. I was lying still, but my whole body felt like it was moving. My heart was racing. My thoughts were tangled tight like a rubber band ball that I once made. My fist and toes were balled up and stuck. When I first met Tiny, even though I knew she was 4 years older than me, I felt protective over her. Maybe it was the way she introduced herself to me after I introduced myself to her. She had said, I'm tiny. I'm small, like a dot. No, like a germ. I'm so small you can't even see me. I'll never forget that. I knew not to ask her why she was locked down. Same as me. Lena taught me that. I knew not to ask her about her past. Sometimes it's too painful to discuss and rude to even ask about, Lena said. Tiny's from New York, the projects out in Yonkers. Her whole family was wiped out in a drug war and not by the police. It was a street war over territory. Tiny's brothers were gun runners turned stick-up. When their family gang began setting up and robbing the drug spots, it took a lot of murder before the dealers discovered who was behind it. When they did discover that it was Tiny's brothers, the war happened over a stretch of only 10 days. Tiny's whole family got wiped out, parents, brothers, and all. Tiny had told me this story herself one day when I was feeling bad. She wanted me to know that her life was way worse than mine. As I listened to her details, I couldn't argue. She was right. Tiny told me she never told nobody her story except for Riot, who was the one who chose Tiny to gang up with the Diamond Needles. Tiny told me that she was going to tell me the ending part that she never even told Riot. She said she was kidnapped by her brother's enemies and tortured for 6 days. One second, guys, I just got triggered. She told me that she was raped and taught me what that really meant and involved. She told me that people always say she's nice looking, but that she feels all nasty on the inside. How did you get away from them? I asked about the kidnappers. That's why I'm here, was all she said. Make sure, Santiago, if some nigga tries to get in between your thighs and you don't want him there, kill him, she said. She said that with a straight face, no tears. In here is safer than out there, Tiny added. After what all happened tonight, I wondered if she still thought so. All the Diamond Needles had stories that make the body shake and tremble. As the personalities of each of my 10 sisters flashed through my mind like a dope ass film that had never been made yet, the moving pictures in my mind paused with Riot in the frame. Riot is number one, and I've been trying to figure her out little by little. As images of the Warden's horror show flipped back and forth in my mind, I kept rewinding so I could figure out the events from the Double Dutch game to the Warden. 40 minutes of reviewing moving reflections in my mind led me to some conclusions. Excuse me. Lena is smart. Riot is scary smart, I thought to myself. Riot somehow knew that the real bitches were setting up to recruit Cha-Cha. Riot also knew that Cha-Cha was my enemy. Riot probably figured that the real bitches were not only trying to copy her style by recruiting young ones from the Sea Dorm, same as she did, but that they were also setting up to challenge the Diamond Needles. Riot knew it all, but didn't show it and didn't react. She didn't and wouldn't fight none of the big, strong black chicks who had named themselves real bitches. Instead, Riot put a plan together and set her army into motion. Each needle in a power position. Riot gave the orders more gentle and quickly than the warden ever could. Riot stood in the gym. Innocence spread across her face. She crawled like the robots, barked like the robots, mooed and hissed like the robots. Then she stripped like the robots. She even told us Diamond Needle girls that our clique had nothing to do with what was happening. I definitely believed her. I am sure Tiny and Hamisha did too. But the fact that the fork was later found in Cha-Cha's bed and the butcher knife tucked inside of the rubber gloves belonging to the leader of the real bitches had me doubting Riot. The fact that Cha-Cha and her leader were both wiped out in one incident, forbidden from the festival, and confined to the bottom during the hottest month of the year made me believe that Riot had set them up as punishment for challenging her and for challenging me. This is what my mind was working out right then. I knew our Diamond Needles clique had a girl working the kitchen detail in the exact place where the fork and knife went missing. I had met Diamond Needle number six, Rose Marie, the Jamaican, when I first went to introduce myself and hand her my candy gift. Riot eliminated my enemy, Cha-Cha, and the leader of the real bitches, both of them threats to our clique, without raising a fist. Like Lena said, we squeeze them. A diamond needle only stings when it feels threatened, unlike other pests who sting as a way of life. Almost 3 hours passed before my thoughts stopped their relay race and my fingers relaxed from my fist. I was wiggling my toes now beneath my thin blanket. Siri squatted by my bed, whispering in my ear. I was feeling a little more at ease, but I wasn't feeling easy enough to begin giggling with her. Where were you? I asked Siri. Where were you when the alarms went off? She covered her ears with her slim fingers and painted natural fingernails. You know I don't like loud noises and screaming, Siri said. So what did you do? I asked her. I hid in the cubicle, she said. How long before you got caught? I asked her. I didn't get caught, she said, but I saw who put the fork in Cha-Cha's bed, she added, now pressing her lips against my ear. Who else saw? I asked swiftly. No one. It was only me watching. Good job, Siri, I told her. Can I put a braid in your hair? Siri asked me. I nodded yes, as she began to stroke my hair like Mama did when she was making sure not to miss even one strand. I felt myself slipping finally into sleep. As I fell, one last thought stuck into my mind, even though I had worked hard to wipe them all away. The guards searched through all our stuff and didn't put anything back the way we had it. They wanted us to know that nothing really belonged to us. They wanted us to know they could take and touch anything that we thought was ours, even our bodies. And that's the end of chapter 8, you guys. All right. So, that was 2 hours and 38 minutes. That's not bad. That's not bad at all. Okay, so let me see. Hey, Evelyn, welcome back. All right, all right, all right. Yes, Wings, life in juvie ain't no joke. Listen, I have, in my very storied career, worked in juvie. If it is a difficult thing to see. Yeah, it's a tough, tough job to sit there and talk to children who only did what they did because they had, you know, parents that were fuck ups from the word go. There's that word again, mother. Yeah, these kids weren't born bad. No child is born bad. Okay, well, maybe Damien, you know, from The Omen. Yeah, he was bad. But, you know, the average child is not born bad. Their environment, their circumstances, you know, their fucked up ass parents and the situations that their parents allow them to find themselves in, either because of a lack of attention or an inability to be attentive to their children. That's the reason why these kids end up doing the shit that they do, you know, becoming part of gangs. These kids are basically scratching and surviving, yo. Like, no bullshit. So yeah, it's a hard thing to witness. You know, even as a doctor, it's a very, very hard thing to witness. Yeah. I've only ever really encountered a couple of children that, you know, we're not supposed to label them. But yeah. They really, really were they were sick. They had some, you know, some mental health issues that were out of control. And I remember, complete transparency here, dropping to my knees and thanking the universe that they were not children that looked like me. Because children are basically products of their environment. So when you have a child who is truly, truly psychotic, yeah. You're always grateful when they don't look like you. And you understand that they were born that way. Yeah. Yeah, you've seen some episodes of Law and Order and SVU where they had a kid that clearly, like, this kid grew up in the lap of luxury and is, you know, fucking other kids up and burning animals. And yeah. That part. The average black kid in juvie is there because they either did something to protect themselves, you know, in some sort of self-defense, or they got caught up trying to get enough to eat and, you know, pay rent in the projects or whatever. You know what I'm saying? It ain't like, you know, they wanted to be doing that shit. their circumstances basically kind of dictated. So yeah. Anyway, that was chapters 1 through 8 of A Deeper Love Inside. So there we are. Depending on how I feel, I may decide to come back out here later for just a regular, degular, schmegular live stream. Or not. I don't know, you guys. But at any rate, we're here and, we'll see. It depends on how I feel. But you guys are so quiet. I swear y'all don't talk or say nothing, Y'all could say something like, hey, yo, bitch, read louder, faster, something. Y'all don't be saying nothing, but I get it. Y'all be listening or whatever. And I appreciate it. I really do so. Oh, I get it, Wings. Y'all don't want to interrupt. I get it. I get it. But I thought that y'all would still be, typing in the chat so I would have something, to read in between, like when I'm in between the what am I trying to say? In between the chapters. So yeah. But it's cool though. So anyway, listen, you guys. I'm going to get out of here. I will set the thumbnail for the next live stream or whatever. I don't I'm not exactly certain when I'm gonna come back. It depends on how I feel, child. Listen, I got a couple of things I need to take care of right quick. And if I feel like it, I may come back. Oh, you were all in the story, child. I was too. Listen, I read this book when it first came out, which like wasn't that long ago. I think it came out yesterday. No, I'm kidding. It just feels like it. But so I, and I, because I started reading the other two books, you kind of forget about Portia's story. So yeah, that part. So hey, Evelyn. Oh, you back? Did you leave or something? Oh, I don't know. I don't know what happened. I just used that phrase earlier today. Oh, did you? Then you would think we wasn't paying attention. No, I mean, well, yeah, I kind of would, but I guess. Oh, yeah, I know, Mother. You're reading while I'm reading. So, like I said, I may come back. This wasn't bad, in 2 hours and 40 minutes, I read 8 chapters. So, yeah, this wasn't bad at all. This was not bad at all. All right, y'all. So listen, I'm gonna get out of here. I thank you guys for coming in here and participating in listening to me read the book or whatever. And like I said, if I decide to come back today, I may, but then again, I may not. It just depends. Uh-oh, this thing is bouncing all over the place, child. Oh, you were in and out having audio issues. Uh-oh, what is going on with YouTube? Okay, I got you. Yes, you are keeping good time stamps, moderator. Yes, thank you for keeping good time stamps, and I was too, and so I will put those in the replay comments so people can, know when, they can just push for their chapter and keep on keeping on. So, oh, okay, Evelyn. And you are welcome, Mother. I actually enjoy this. I kind of like it. I wish that I had the patience that I used to have. I do, but not for reading out loud. Because I would finish this book, child, in a couple days, but, God, these folks don't tip their content creators or nothing. I'm just like, I know you lying. I'm not gonna sit up here for no 10 hours and read a book and people don't even say, hey girl, here go a dollar or something. Like y'all are trash. But then y'all, not y'all, but I'm just saying like people are trash, I just feel like, what the hell? Somebody sitting up here reading to you, so you ain't got to read the damn book. All you got to do is listen. You be done clean your whole house, 20 pounds of chitlins, 40 pounds of chicken wings, and sold your mama a brand new dress for Mother's Day. And you was entertained the whole time. I know you lying. Awesome, unappreciative rascal. Well, anyway, let me get on out of here, y'all. I love y'all, and I appreciate you again for being here. Oh, you are welcome, Choco Chip. You are welcome. Enjoy the reading. I'm going to replay some of the others. I'll be back next reading. All right, Wings. Thank you for being here and welcome, because I don't think I've ever seen your name, but clearly you have been subscribed to the Speakeasy. You might have changed your name or something, child. I don't know. Listen, I don't know everybody who is sub to me, but I'm glad you're here and I appreciate you. All right, you guys. Oh, thank you, Mother. Now you know. I wasn't talking to you. But thank you though. I appreciate you listening.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you, Mother. I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. No, I'm talking about these folks in the clouds and bushes just sitting up there picking boogers and doing nothing. And that, look, look, now this little baby want to hear the music too. I wish I would have put the.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Y'all, that bangs in your speakers. It really does. It bangs in the speakers. But anyway, so listen, thank you guys. I'm trying to decide what I will come back, whether I will come back and just do a, kicking the Willy Bobo, or if I will come back and read some more, or come back and maybe do another viewer letter. I'm not certain. I'll figure it out. I'm not sure if I. Uh-oh. Okay. Thank you, Evil Lynn. Thank you. Thank you, man.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. So I'll figure out. And thank you, Bikini. I'm sorry, I forgot to say her name for the last one, my bad. But yes. So I really I have to figure it out. Like I said, I might decide to just go and child, it's hot outside. I might decide to go play some games in the pool with my husband, get in a little practice. Have a little swimming lesson, if you know what I mean. Anyway, stay out my business. All right, I love y'all. Thank y'all so much. I appreciate you guys. I am going to get out of here. Please, if you do nothing else, love each other. Love on your families. Call somebody that you ain't talked to in a minute and just say, hey, I was thinking about you. Okay? And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to my moderators. And until I come back, bye, y'all.
Thank you.